Thank you. Always remember you can get caught in the hop in here if something collapses early. The next item of business is a debate on motion number 1531 in the name of Keith Brown on Scotland's economy responding to the EU referendum. Can I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now? And I call on the Cabinet Secretary Keith Brown to speak to and move motion. 15 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and apologies for being caught on the hop and being late for the start of the debate. This is, as you'll know, the second in a series of debates focused on the challenges facing Scotland as a result of the recent EU referendum. I think at the outset of this debate, it's important to restate a fundamental point about the Scottish vote at the referendum and about Scottish democracy. In that referendum, people in every single local authority area of Scotland voted to remain. More than 60% of voters in Scotland wanted to stay in the EU to protect the jobs, the investment and the trade that depend upon our membership of the EU. So the people of Scotland, the Scottish Government and a clear majority in this Parliament support continued membership of the EU, and in that respect we are protecting Scotland's interests. The onus then is on those who want to drag Scotland to the EU exit door to justify why the wishes of the people of Scotland should be ignored in that way. So the Scottish Government's overriding priority is protecting Scotland's relationship with and its place in the European Union and all its benefits. And business and the economy is at the heart of that. Last week's debate was essentially about getting the right deal for Scotland, the very best deal for Scotland, in circumstances not of our choosing, and reaffirming that as a shared aim of every member in this chamber and everyone in our country. And today I think we must take a similarly strategic view, but we must also recognise the vital importance of acting now to address more immediate economic challenges. And just to be clear, it is our view the fundamentals of our economy remain strong. Despite uncertain global conditions and falling oil prices, which we all know about, our economy has continued to grow over the last year. Scotland is and remains an attractive and stable place to do business. However, there is no doubt that the referendum outcome presents a significant challenge to our economy, both now and in the future. It has already created deep and widespread uncertainty, with jobs and investment likely to come under threat. In the lead-up to the EU referendum, the Scottish economy continued to demonstrate resilience in the face of ongoing external headwinds associated with weak global growth and the low oil price impacting on the oil and gas sector and its supply chain. In 2015, Scotland's economy grew by 2.1%, which is in line with the historical trend of GDP growth rates for Scotland, despite those challenges. Whilst economic growth was flat in the first quarter of 2016, employment expanded by 51,000 during the latest quarter, the largest quarterly rise on record. And unemployment at 4.7% is currently at its lowest rate since June to August 2008. In fact, I think from looking at the records, one of the lowest unemployment rates that we've had in the past 25 years. So the underlying economic data remains strong. There is much to be positive about that data. But the reality is that post-referendum uncertainty represents an ongoing challenge to businesses across Scotland and the UK as a whole. I will do.
Mr. Fraser.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. The Purchasing Managers Index, which was published just last week, demonstrated that business confidence had returned in every part of the United Kingdom to pre-Brexit vote levels, with one exception, that was Scotland. So every region of England, Wales and Northern Ireland, business confidence was back up and positive. Only in Scotland does business confidence remain below pre-Brexit levels. Can the Cabinet Secretary explain why he thinks this is?
Cabinet Secretary.
And yet, unemployment is lower in Scotland than it is in the rest of the UK. Employment is higher, one of the highest levels we've ever had of employment in Scotland. And I would say this in relation to the businesses in Scotland, that I don't think they benefit from the Tory approach, which is to call them fat and lazy. Yes, I don't know how they think that helps businesses in Scotland or the rest of the UK. Neither does Brexit help them. And it doesn't help them either that they, in fact, it's not the economy spokesperson. The Tory economy spokesperson is never allowed to talk about these issues. It has to be Murdo-Fraser instead. Constantly referring to the fact that Brexit does not provide challenges, and the only song in Murdo-Fraser's songbook is the Scottish independence referendum. By ignoring the challenges of Brexit.
Yeah.
And even more incredible,
to have a
press release issued yesterday which Murdo-Fraser says it's down to the Scottish Government to solve the problems of Brexit, where it's his own party that's brought Brexit upon us. So I think we will go with what we've done in terms of trying to help the Scottish economy rather than what the Tories have not done. But the exit, or proposed exit from the EU, has also prompted a substantial downward revision for output in 2017. And the analysis that we produced is that Scottish GDP is projected to be between £1.7 billion and £11.2 billion per year lower than it would have been if Brexit does not occur. Tax revenue is projected to be between £1.7 and £3.7 billion lower. Now, we know that these forecasts are, of course, contingent on political and other events and the reaction to those political events by the various actors in the economy. What is clear is that the immediate uncertainty caused by the vote is impacting economic sentiment and business confidence. Now, there's never any mention, of course, from Murdo-Fraser about the problems in terms of Brexit. But if you look at some other people that do have a view on this, like the American president, or we look at the Koreans, or we look at the note from the Japanese government, or we even look at his prime minister, Theresa May, who's acknowledged difficulties ahead, at least they can see the problems which Brexit will bring, even if Murdo-Fraser cannot. And we've seen evidence of this in a range of post-referendum business surveys as well, from the Bank of Scotland, the PMI report that Murdo-Fraser mentioned, the Scottish Chambers of Commerce and the Fraser of Allender Institute all pointed out to the problems being incurred by the prospect of Brexit. And last week, Highlands and Islands Enterprise published an analysis of the views of 1,000 businesses, with more than half, confirming that the EU referendum result, something which is not acknowledged by the Conservative Party, had made them less confident. He asked for an explanation as to why that might be. Less confident about the economic outlook for Scotland. Well, the report was done by Highlands and Islands Enterprise, and that's who they asked. Now, we are clear that the policy that we have must support the economy given this business environment, and that there should be two governments. We're always told, in fact, David Mundell refers to this regularly, there are two governments working tirelessly, apparently, to support Scotland's economy. It's hard to see exactly what the work has been done by the UK government since they've yet to announce anything in terms of a fiscal stimulus, in terms of infrastructure or capital investment. But we're always told this, except, of course, when the unemployment figures suit Murdo-Fraser, then it's only one government that's in Scotland. And even though his own party, Gavin Brown, previously said the UK government retains most of the economic levers, it's all down to the Scottish government is bad. And when, of course, the figures are good, not a mention from the Tory party about very good employment figures. Now, the Bank of England, I would acknowledge, has taken some action to stimulate the economy, including a cut in the bank rate, the introduction of a term funding scheme, and the expansion of the quantitative easing programme. And as far as it goes, I would welcome those measures. But the Conservative government in Westminster is in stark contrast to this government, ignoring the challenges of Brexit and alienating, sometimes purposely, calling them fat and lazy, our business leaders. The Prime Minister, as I say, has acknowledged that departure from the EU... Yes, I will.
Mr Lockhart.
The Cabinet Secretary talks about a strong Scottish economy. Is he aware that every year the SNP government has been in power, the Scottish economy has either underperformed the UK in terms of economic growth or has been in recession? How is that being stronger for Scotland?
I think if you look at a longer term, you go back 25 years, you'll see too often that has been the case in the past. And what you'll also see during the time of this government is frequently the employment figures in Scotland are far better to those than they are in the rest of the UK. So, of course, it's the case that we have to deal with long-term issues, including a lack of growth, as we know, is the case both in Scotland and in the UK. But these issues are compounded by the fact, in my view, that the economic levers, which the Tory party itself says mainly reside in Westminster, are not being sufficiently used to the benefit of the Scottish economy, ignoring the challenges of Brexit and alienating business leaders. As I say, the Prime Minister has acknowledged that departure from the EU will bring difficult times to the country. I'm hopeful that we hear from the Conservative benches when they get the chance to speak what their view is. Should Scotland stay part of the single market? It'd be interesting to hear if that's addressed by either the economy spokesperson, if he's allowed to speak, or Murdo-Fraser, who more usually does so. President Obama, as I've said, has said that the United States would guard against any adverse impacts on the Brexit vote, but warned that a trade deal with the UK was not Washington's top priority. Earlier this month, the Japanese government issued an unprecedented warning about the impact on jobs and investment of giving up single market privileges. It said Japanese businesses with their European headquarters in the UK may decide to transfer their head office function to continental Europe if EU laws cease to be applicable in the UK after its withdrawal. that we are going to meet, myself and Mike Russell are going to meet with Japanese businesses and with the Japanese Consul General to try and give them the true impression of how things are in Scotland to try and mitigate that threat. And as I've said, calling business across the UK is fat and lazy. It's not the way we should be responding to that situation. On economic and financial issues, we need the UK government to provide answers on key questions. We need to know, for example, are workers' rights going to be protected? We need to know if a new holiday visa tax will be introduced for people travelling to the EU. Indeed. And for the economy, despite repeated demands, as I've just said, there have been no answers on the most important question of all: will the UK remain inside the single market? Or to make it an easier question, do you believe, whoever speaks for the Conservative Party in this debate, do you believe that the UK should remain inside the single market? It's a fairly simple question. It would answer a lot of fears amongst businesses, so let's hear the answer from the Conservatives. And before the referendum, I will do.
Mr. Harvey.
I'm grateful for the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. Does he agree, as I think the Scottish Government has been this clear, but does he agree with me that to be part of a single market implies absolutely the retention of free movement? If capital is free to move but people are not, that is not a single market.
Cabinet Secretary.
Patrick Harvey is absolutely right. And if you think about some of the major infrastructure projects that we have, our ability to deliver these infrastructure projects is fundamentally limited if we don't have that free movement of peoples across the EU and coming to Scotland. Before the referendum, the leader of the Scottish Conservatives was adamant that answers were required. And she said to those who were campaigning to leave, they won't tell us how much our economy will be hit by, they won't tell us how many jobs might go, they won't tell us what they're going to replace a single market with. Now that the Conservatives seem to be united behind the Leave position, it defies belief that they still won't answer those questions. In fact, they won't even ask those questions here in Scotland now that were asked so forcefully before by Ruth Davidson. So what are the answers? We know how important the answers are to business, but support for continued single market membership was a position that was endorsed by the main business organisations in Scotland when they issued a joint statement in July. So we need a clear answer. Does the UK government want to stay in that single market or not? And answering that question is the most important action the UK government could take. And it's not just me saying that in a debate in the Scottish Parliament. Businesses are asking that question and they deserve an answer. In the debate that follows, I would welcome, in addition to that answer, constructive ideas about how we can further support economic growth and from MSPs across the chamber. And in that spirit, I would urge the Chancellor to explore two key measures that the Treasury could take to protect and create jobs despite that continued uncertainty. First of all, increased capital spending. An increase in the UK infrastructure spend of £5 billion could provide an additional £400 million spend in Scotland. That would support around 3,000 jobs. Increased support for exporters. I think there's general agreement about the need to drive up our exports. The depreciation of sterling represents challenges to businesses in the UK, admittedly, but it also presents opportunities for companies to either move into new export markets or start exporting for the first time. The UK should be investing more to support that. And those measures could encourage investment, recruitment, exports and growth. And I'm putting them forward as a clear plan for how the UK government can help at this critical juncture for our economy. And I hope the Chancellor will act as soon as the autumn statement, but ideally even in shorter order than that. For our part, we've taken decisive and positive action to support and stimulate the economy, building on the established economic strategy. £100 million of capital investment provides immediate support to the Scottish economy. We've set up a new dedicated service to answer questions from businesses affected by referendum uncertainty. A new post-referendum business network will work closely with the main business bodies, the Scottish Trade Unions Congress and the Scotland Office, and forms part of a wider upgrade to our engagement with businesses and sectors. Understanding their knowledge and experience is vital if we are to support them fully in the months ahead. We're providing support to businesses with high growth potential through a £500 million Scottish Growth Scheme to provide investment guarantees and some loans of up to £5 million for eligible businesses over the next 3 years. And that will focus on new and early stage businesses. I'm sorry, I'm very short of time now. I've only got a short time left to finish. It will focus on new and early stage businesses with high growth potential and clear export growth plans. We've approved European Structural Fund projects to invest in our economy with a total value of £290 million of grant. And with partner funding, that means an additional £650 million being invested in Scotland's people, communities and businesses. And we're increasing the supply of affordable housing in Scotland. We're implementing the recommendations of the Independent Review of Planning to ensure we have a strong high-performing planning system that supports housing and infrastructure delivery. We're improving connectivity through strategic investments in our transport infrastructure and in our digital connectivity. We're supporting investment in Scotland's cities and regions through our city and regional partnership deals. We're continuing to offer a competitive business rates regime. Small business bonus scheme offers zero or substantially reduced rates, and we've committed to expanding that scheme from next year to remove the rates burden entirely from 100,000 premises. We've commissioned an external review of business rates, but led by Ken Barclay, to make recommendations on how the rate system could be further improved. And we're working to make Scotland a more internationally focused economy by piloting innovation and investment hubs at key global locations, including London, Brussels and Dublin, to support trade, to support investment and innovation. And we'll also widen and deepen our business engagement to share our response, shape our response to the EU referendum and wider trade and investment activity, establishing new trade envoys on which I hope to have discussions with the other parties in the Parliament, and a ministerial trade board, and listening to and engaging with businesses through existing engagement structures, sector-specific international trade summits, and a dedicated investor forum for critical inward investment. So I'll finish where I began, Presiding Officer. A more competitive and inclusive economy will ensure Scotland can withstand the economic shocks, sustain that higher employment I mentioned, and create better quality jobs and fairer work. Our economic priority is protecting Scotland's relationship with and place in the European Union. So I would move that the Parliament welcomes the overwhelming vote of the people of Scotland to remain in the EU, notes that leaving the EU is widely expected to have a negative impact on economic growth and public sector revenues, as well as access to labour, inward investment and opportunities to export, as well as threatening essential economic and social protections, and recognises the continued resilience of Scottish businesses and the urgent need to support and stimulate the economy in the wake of the EU referendum. And we note the initial steps taken by the Scottish Government and calls on the UK Government to bring forward a substantial stimulus package instead of the complete paralysis that we see just now in the UK Government to boost business confidence, keep our economy moving, end austerity and endorse the vital importance of growing an inclusive, productive and sustainable economy with more jobs and fair work. Presiding Officer, I move the motion in my name.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I now call Murdo-Fraser to speak to move amendment 1531.1. 11 minutes or thereabout, please, Mr. Fraser.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased that the Cabinet Secretary was able to join us this afternoon, although I'm a little bit disappointed that his speech seemed to be more about attacking the Conservative opposition than setting out any detailed proposals as to what new ideas the Scottish Government has to take us forward. Let me start, if I can, by putting this debate in some context, because 7 days ago, the long-established Stirling retailer, Macaree Brothers, announced it was closing its doors after 138 years of trading in the city. As mentioned in the local press, this is a severe blow to the retail economy in the centre of Stirling. And there's no doubt where the responsibility lies. The company itself is quite clear that it was the burden, the crippling burden of business rates that led to this decision being taken. And in particular, they blame the large business supplement introduced by the SNP government, which meant that a business like theirs, not actually a large business, but one operating from middle-sized retail premises, was being punished. This is a large business supplement introduced in Scotland at double the rate payable in England and Wales, and therefore putting Scottish businesses at a competitive disadvantage. And the reason, Presiding Officer, that I mention this at the outset is to reinforce the point that right here, right now, there are issues more serious than the consequences of Brexit affecting the Scottish economy. And as our amendment today makes clear, even before the Brexit vote in June, there were issues with Scotland's economic underperformance which required to be addressed and still need attention today. Now, as the Cabinet Secretary said, we had good news in unemployment published last week, when against the trend in recent years, we have seen Scottish unemployment dip below the UK level. But across a whole range of indicators, Scottish economic performance is lagging behind the UK as a whole. Whether that is GDP growth, retail sales or business confidence, we are not doing as well as we should be. And this debunks the myth being put about in some quarters that any problems with the Scottish economy are purely the responsibility of the Brexit vote. Yes, Mr. Crawford, I will.
Mr. Crawford.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I wonder, does Murdo-Fraser agree with David Mundell when he said in May that leaving the EU would be an absolute disaster for Scotland? Now he says in September that Brexit has amazing possibilities for Scotland. Which one of these would he choose from?
Mr.
Fraser. Like my good friend, Mr. Mundell, I did not support the UK leaving the EU, but that is a democratic choice of the British people in a referendum that people in Scotland participated in. What we have to get on is make the best of the situation. Instead of sitting negatively on the sidelines and carping, we have to make the best of the situation. But let me say a bit more about where we are with the Scottish economy. Maybe I can suggest to Mr Crawford and his colleagues some positive things we could all be doing to try and help the situation. Because the situation with the Scottish economy is set out very starkly in last week's publication by the Fraser of Allender Institute on Scotland's budget 2016. In the section on outlook for the Scottish economy, the Institute comments that there is an ongoing divergence between Scottish and UK economic growth, with production and manufacturing in Scotland in particular dragging down overall growth. In terms of output per head, the UK is growing more quickly, with growth in Scotland of just 0.4% compared to the UK's 1.4% over the past year. Immediately prior to the EU referendum, the pace of growth in Scotland weakened further, with both production and construction sectors contracting. This is a situation which should be a worrying one for the Scottish Government, and as the Institute makes clear, all this data predates the Brexit vote. But perhaps the most worrying set of statistics published recently was the Purchasing Managers Index Business Activity Report, which came out last week, which I referred to earlier when I intervened on the Cabinet Secretary. Now, when the figures came out for July, it was not perhaps surprising that in the immediate aftermath of the Brexit vote, we saw a slump in business confidence in every single part of the United Kingdom as a reaction to the uncertainty caused by the outcome of that vote. But the figures for August tell us a different story. In every part of the UK, business confidence is returning, with one exception. So it is up in Northern Ireland to a two-month high, up in Wales to a five-month high, up in the southeast of England to a five-month high, in the southwest of England to a 13-month high, in the northwest to a seven-month high. The only part of the United Kingdom where business confidence has not returned post-Brexit is here in Scotland. Now, why should this be? What is it about Scotland uniquely that means that business confidence has returned? I asked the Cabinet Secretary earlier to explain this. He was unable to do so. And what we also see from these figures is that even in those parts of the UK which voted to remain in the EU, like London or Northern Ireland, they have seen their business confidence returning in August. Only Scotland is the exception. It is only in Scotland where we have this issue. And I would suggest, because the Cabinet Secretary can't give us an explanation, there's one very obvious conclusion to draw from these figures. The unique Scottish problem, the one that's holding back Scottish recovery, is the one issue they don't want to talk about on the front bench, their obsession with an independence referendum. And we've seen in the recent weeks a whole range of business figures saying that the last thing Scotland needs at this point is another referendum. The last thing we need is another period of economic uncertainty. And yet, 2 years on from that last vote, one which we were told would be a once-in-a-generation vote, all we hear from SNP figures is about how and when another referendum should take place. Astonishingly, we even had the First Minister at the weekend on the front page of the Sunday Herald telling us that the case for independence transcends the economic argument. Never mind the economy, just close your eyes and vote for independence, presiding officer. Now, it might be that there is another explanation, but they need to tell us what the other explanation is, and we haven't heard that yet. Oh, yes, please.
Cabinet Secretary.
I noticed we didn't get very far down the list of actions which you were going to propose to help the economy. In fact, we didn't get anywhere at all. But could you at least try and answer the one question? Do you believe that Scotland and the UK should stay with access to the single market or not?
I noticed the Cabinet Secretary didn't even attempt to answer my question to him about an explanation for the lack of business confidence. But being a courteous and generous man, let me address his question directly. I think what's important to Scottish business and UK business is having access to the single market. That's what's important. The concept of membership on the single market is an esoteric thing. As my learned colleague Adam Tompkins has pointed out on many occasions, what's important is access to the single market. That's what we should be striving for. Now, the Scottish Government's motion today is very heavy on calls for what the UK Government should do. It's almost as if the Scottish Government had no tools at its disposal, that they were completely helpless. There's nothing they could do to try and improve our economic performance. In reality, there's a huge amount they can and should be doing. And they should start, presiding officer, with business rates. Now, I quoted earlier the example of Macquarie Brothers in Stirling, just one business that's been suffering the business rates burden. There are many other examples from across the country, but I'm sure other members in this chamber could quote. And business rates are nothing to do with the UK government. They are entirely the responsibility of the Scottish government. If there is a need to stimulate the economy in the wake of the EU referendum and deal with the uncertainty that the Cabinet Secretary was talking about, then this is an area where they can and should be taking action. So they need to scrap the large business supplement, a misnamed policy if ever there were one, for many modest-sized retail premises are affected. And they need to take our advice and freeze business rates for the next 5 years in the same way council tax was frozen for the previous nine. That would deliver a real benefit to Scottish businesses and perhaps, as importantly, send a signal to the world that Scotland is an attractive place to come and work and set up a business and invest. And continual messages from the Scottish Government about higher taxes in Scotland will simply put people off from investing and expanding their businesses here. Add to that the uncertainty around a second possible independence referendum, and it's little wonder we are seeing the Scottish economy struggle, and yet at a stroke, the Scottish Government has the power to resolve these two issues immediately. Now, we know there are concerns in the business community about the uncertainties caused by the Brexit vote, and we completely accept that. But some of the doom and gloom we have heard a few weeks ago has already been dispelled. Both Morgan Stanley and Credit Suisse, who were back in June predicting a UK recession, have now changed their minds and said there won't be a recession. And what we should be aware of is that there are opportunities which will be afforded by the UK leaving the EU. In the short term, many sectors of the economy have benefited from the Brexit vote. The fall in the value of the pound has been of considerable benefit to the domestic tourist industry. Now, we've yet to see official figures, but anecdotally, my impression is, talking to people in the sector, that it has been a very busy summer. A month ago, I was in the West Highlands in Katie Forbes' constituency, visiting the same location I was in last year at the same time, and I must say it was noticeably busier this year, particularly with European visitors. On a rough count, one in three of the vehicles on the roads belonged to visitors from elsewhere in Europe, France, the Netherlands, or Germany. And with the pound buying fewer euros abroad, there seems to have been a rise in staycations with more UK residents taking holidays here. Exporters too have benefited from the fall in the pound, and for industries like food and drink, which are so important to Scotland, that is of great significance. So the question for the Scottish Government is this: what steps are they taking to assist businesses to take advantage of these opportunities? We know, for example, that the fishing industry sees a great future outside the EU. What is the Scottish Government doing to develop a distinctive fishing policy for Scotland to help that industry grow in its new environment? What is the Scottish... No, thank you. I'm running out of time.
You've got a little time if you want to.
Well, I'll give way. You can tell us what the Government's doing about the fishing industry.
Will the member acknowledge that the fish catching industry is of one view, but the fish processing industry that depends crucially on the free movement of labour is absolutely behind not just having access to the single market, but being a member of the single market?
Mr. Fraser.
I'm afraid the member of that information didn't make any attempt to address my question, which is, given that we're moving into this new environment, what is his party and his government doing to try and seize the opportunities from Brexit to help develop a new fishing policy for Scotland that might address the concerns he has raised? He has nothing to say on that point, and neither, it seems, does his government. What is the Scottish Government going to do to develop a new farming policy for Scotland, given that support payments for agriculture will no longer be paid from Europe, have to be paid domestically? There is a huge opportunity awaiting us to design a new agricultural support system tailored to the needs of Scottish agriculture, rather than one being handed down from Brussels. Is the Scottish Government doing anything at all to try and progress this? And what is being done to promote exports at this time? The Economy Committee in the last Parliament, that I had the honour of convening, said at that time that Scottish businesses needed more help with export advice. Ruth Davidson called in the summer for Scottish Development International to be expanded to help gain new markets abroad. Today, the opportunity for exporting is greater than it has been for many years. But what is being done to seize this moment? And what is being done to look at how we best support large-scale businesses, given that EU state aid rules may no longer apply in the future? What is being done to look at the opportunities for developing a new consumption tax, given the EU rules around VAT may no longer apply? Presiding officer, there are a whole range of policy opportunities for us, given our departure from the EU. And yet, rather than take these forward, rather than be positive about the future, all the SNP government want to do is sit on the sidelines and complain and carp. Presiding officer, Scottish businesses expect the government here in Edinburgh to do all it can to support the Scottish economy. We on this side of the chamber are positive and optimistic about Scotland's future within the UK and outside the EU. I hope Scottish ministers can find it in themselves to be less dismal, less miserable, less downbeat, less pessimistic, to be more positive, to be more cheerful, to be more hopeful, to show some real leadership in seizing the opportunities for the future. That is the point made in my amendment today, which I have pleasure in moving.
Thank you very much. I now call Richard Leonard to speak to and move Amendment 1531.3. Mr Leonard, 8 minutes or thereabouts, please. A little time in hand.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In the wake of the Brexit vote, the Fraser-Valander Institute, in a survey of 320 firms across Scotland, found that 60% believe that the outcome of the EU referendum will have a negative effect on their business. Even more, 67% believed the uncertainty it created was an additional problem. And as we all know, the people who will suffer most from any business downturn are those working people who are already on the most precarious contracts, those who already are the lowest paid, those who are already in the deepest in-work poverty, the people living from week to week. These are the victims of any economic collapse as a result of Brexit, and they are the people this Parliament must speak up for. The Cabinet Secretary in this motion is calling on the UK Treasury to come up with a counter-cyclical fiscal stimulus package, and we support that. But we call on the Cabinet Secretary to join with us in calling on his own government to do more to stimulate investment. The £100 million stimulus package is welcome, but we know that it is not enough. In fact, when it was announced, even Murdo-Fraser was on BBC Radio Scotland arguing that it simply wasn't enough. I don't know whether his summer reading was John Maynard Keynes' General Theory of Employment, Interest and Money, but it seems to have had the effect. I also note his support for state aid of industry as well this afternoon. I want to draw the Cabinet Secretary's attention to a report which the National Institute for Economic and Social Research brought out recently, in which they conclude, and I know this is something close to him and his thinking, they conclude that infrastructure spending strengthens the supply side of the economy with the potential to create a permanent increase in GDP around the region of 0.5%, a permanent increase of 0.5%. So we are calling today for a new infrastructure investment programme, starting with a house building programme and an existing homes investment programme, because as I mentioned in the housing debate last week, 16,000 jobs have been lost from the construction industry in Scotland over the last 5 years. Half of those, 8,000 jobs, have been lost from the construction industry in the last year. And as I said to his colleague, the Minister for Housing, last week, if his targets have been exceeded, then there was something wrong with his targets in the first place, if all of those people in that industry are out of work. So the times we find ourselves in demand, then, the kind of stimulus package the Scottish Government has called for, with infrastructure spend and house building at its core, but of, in our view, of a greater order. But it demands not simply a reflation of the old economy, not simply taking the tears out of capitalism, as somebody once described it, but building up a new economy. Deputy Presiding Officer, there is an aspect of our economy which is often overlooked and underplayed, but which we believe is fundamental to this debate on Brexit this afternoon. And that is the question of the ownership and control of the Scottish economy. Figures which we are publishing today reveal that over a third, 34.6% to be precise, of the Scottish economy is now overseas owned. That's considerably higher than any other part of the UK. So whilst the SNP have been fixating on political sovereignty, they have presided in office, but maybe not in power, over an historic loss in economic sovereignty. When the SNP came to power in 2007, less than a quarter of Scotland's economic base was owned externally. Now it is over a third. The speed and scale of this loss of economic sovereignty is huge, and I would put it down to the fact that there has been no industrial strategy and no serious challenge to this.
Will the member take an intervention?
Yes, I will.
Mr. Stevenson.
I'm listening with interest to the point that Mr. Leonard's developing. Is he arguing that Scottish companies and investors should not be able to invest overseas in companies in other countries to support economic efforts here? And before he answers it, he may consider that Scottish companies have higher levels of investment internationally to integrate and join markets to the benefit of the wider economy.
Mr. Leonard.
Yeah, well, yes, I'm concerned about the export of capital as well as the high levels of inward investment and the failure to develop sufficiently the indigenous industrial base. And I also say to the member, because I thought this might come up, and I checked, the First Minister said to the SNP conference on the eve of the Scottish Parliament elections of 2007, you may remember the speech well, "We will stand up for our businesses and our industries. We will encourage them to grow and we'll defend them when they are under threat. That's what governments do the length and breadth of Europe, and that's what an SNP government will do." You've singularly failed to do it. Those figures prove that you've singularly failed to do it.
Cabinet Secretary.
An intervention, and if I could mention just maybe three examples, NEOS at Grangemouth, Prestwick Airport and Tata Steel. Yeah. I think it is the case that this government has protected Indigenous investment, Indigenous businesses. But is he trying to say there is no link between political sovereignty and economic sovereignty?
Mr. Leonard.
No, there's a very strong coincidence of link between political and economic sovereignty. But if I can return to my point, which is to look at the position of Scotland compared to other parts of the UK. The Scottish level of external ownership of the economy stands at 34.6%. The next nearest part of the UK to that is the West Midlands of England with 30%. London has 27%, which is about the average for the UK. And of course, this has huge implications for the way the economy functions and where decisions are made. But it also means, and this is the point that's relevant to this afternoon's debate, it also means that we are more vulnerable to international shocks like the effects of withdrawal from the European Union and the single market than any other part of the UK. So, for those overseas-owned businesses which invest here to gain access to the European Union single market, there is a risk. The Scottish Government's own report brought out in August said that 79% of investors listed access to the European Union single market as an important element of the UK's attractiveness for investment. For those businesses headquartered elsewhere in the European Union, there is a risk of divestment. That same Scottish Government report estimated that there are nearly 1,000 European Union-owned companies operating in Scotland, employing 115,000 working people. So, for those Scottish-located businesses which exist as part of a European Union-based chain of production, there is a danger from tariff barriers and to intra-company supply chains, and not least in those parts of the economy which are, to all intents and purposes, screwdriver plants. So real jobs are at risk. The more our economy looks like a branch plant and wholly-owned subsidiary economy, the more vulnerable it becomes. So I hope that one of the lessons we take from this, the state of our economy, is the need to invest in, through an industrial strategy, the indigenous base of the economy. And instead of control and ownership lying in a minority of hands, often abroad, we should be looking at ways in which we build up our internal economic infrastructure. And if I can turn, in closing, Deputy Presiding Officer, to a comment made at last week's Economy, Jobs and Fair Work Committee by Professor Colin Mason, where he made some telling points, and I would recommend all members look at Professor Mason's evidence to the committee. He said, I quote, "Having independent, locally owned, solid, middle-sized companies in Scotland is important, not least because their head offices are in Scotland. So let's use the occasion of Brexit to take a fresh approach to our economy. Let's charge the Scottish Investment Bank with building up homegrown businesses. Let's work with trade unions and businesses in locking in external investment, in building local linkages. Let's get an industrial policy which builds from the bottom up, rather than one which is over-reliant on unstable foreign direct investment. And let's look at how we can reclaim the economy so that it is run and its long-term strategic decisions are made in the interests of working people. Deputy Presiding Officer, I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Mr. Leonard. We're now going to move to the open debate. Can I ask all members to make sure they've pressed the request to speak buttons now, particularly if they've made an intervention, because the button goes off then. I call Joan McAlpine, be followed by Liam Kerr. Up to 6 minutes or thereabouts, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I was rather alarmed to read recently in the Financial Times that our fate appears to be in the hands of the Chancellor, Philip Hammond, who has emerged as the sole voice of common sense in the Cabinet, holding the thin blue line to protect access to the single market against the three Brexiteers, Boris Johnson, David Davis and Liam Fox, who appear to believe that sailing off in the good ships Britannia will sometimes make it all right on the night and that Britain can sail into the sunset without sinking. The challenges of Brexit are far, far more serious than that, and the initial evidence taken by the Parliament's European and External Relations Committee is clear. When a number of us visited Brussels, we met with the British Chamber of Commerce, who were striking in their warnings. They in particular made it clear to us the dangers to foreign direct investment in the UK from being outside of the single market. They pointed out that membership of the single market was key to attracting foreign direct investment from outside the EU, from China, Japan, the United States. In fact, the warning from the Chamber in Brussels has since been fleshed out, not least by the document prepared by the Japanese government. The Chamber made the point to us that foreign direct investors often look to the UK as the default option for investment in the EU. They made the point that the UK actually punched above its weight in the EU. That was because it was part of an Anglophone area. But of course, we've lost that advantage, and the British Chamber of Commerce said that they already knew of deals that had fallen through as a result of the uncertainty caused by Brexit. And obviously, foreign direct investment is one of Scotland's great success stories. The Ernst & Young, the EY Attractiveness Survey in May 2016, showed that in 2015, Scotland attracted more foreign direct investment projects than anywhere in the UK apart from London. And a report by the Fraser of Allender Institute has noted that Scotland's comparative success in attracting international investment could be slowed down as a result of Brexit. Scotland's main business organisations, the Scottish Chamber of Commerce, the Federation of Small Businesses, Confederation of British Industry, the Institute of Directors, the Scottish Financial Enterprise, Scottish Council Development Industry, issued a joint statement on the 8th of July confirming that Scotland businesses need continued access to the single market to prosper. And that was also the clear view of those who gave evidence to the European Committee over the summer. And I note that a number of Conservatives have been trying to distinguish between access to the single market and membership of the single market. That is a misleading distinction. As I said last week in the debate, the single market is not a pick and mix affair. It's built on four freedoms: the freedom of movement, freedom of capital, freedom of services and freedom of investment. And it's all or nothing. You can't pick or choose. You lose. For example, Switzerland, although it is a member of EFTA, is outside the EEA, and that means deals that have to be negotiated with the EU do not include services. And as we know, services account for a growing aspect of Scottish and UK exports, and they are the pillar on which the economies of our great cities, such as Glasgow and Edinburgh, are based. Even membership of EFTA and the EEA still puts those countries outside the EU customs union, and being outside that customs union means that businesses have to prove country of origin, and so therefore they're subject to a great deal more red tape than they are within the single market. Indeed, the Fraser of Allender Institute, giving evidence to the committee, suggested that the paperwork for proving country of origin alone would add about 1-2% to business costs. Agricultural products from EFTA countries and those outside the EU will be subject to immediate tariffs. And On the subject of farming, will the money that the UK saves in payments to the EU come back to Scotland to construct a new system of support for agriculture? Will the payments that come back compensate for that? As for, we just don't know. We don't know that Scotland can construct a new system of agriculture because we agricultural support because we don't know how much of the cap payments are going to come to Scottish farmers. At the moment, cap payments to Scottish farmers amount to 18%, way above our population plus share of the block grant that comes to Scotland through Barnett. We haven't been told if we will maintain those 18% farm payments. And similarly with fishing, the evidence received by the committee suggested that control of fishing grounds themselves, because they're part of UK maritime boundaries, actually stays with the UK government. Indeed, there's already been speculation that continued access to our fishing grounds could be a bargaining chip in the UK's negotiating position in terms of securing a deal with the EU. That's extremely worrying. I just wanted to conclude by reflecting on a little bit more on trade, as we certainly some of the comments that have been made at UK level suggest we're heading to a hard Brexit, which will mean a return to WTO rules in the short to medium terms. And there are a number of commentators who believe this will take place even if the government's intention is to negotiate a trade deal with the EU, because the Article 50 process means that you cannot actually negotiate that those trade deals until the Article 50 process is finished. So you will revert to WTO rules even in the medium term. Now, it's already been said by a number of commentators that the UK doesn't have the skills in that area. What concerns me is that even when they get up to speed, if they get up to speed in that area, where is Scotland going to be in negotiating those trade deals, both at EU level and with countries out with the EU? We've not been told we're part of the conversation, and we need to hear exactly what Scotland's input is going to be from now on, both in terms of building a UK negotiating position and in the longer term in negotiating the best possible deals for our trade. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Liam Kerr to be followed by Kate Forbes. Mr Kerr, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This debate is called Responding to the EU Referendum, and I was saddened to see the motion from the Scottish Government, which continues to show two clear things. The rather negative, reactionary, pessimistic and rather unedifying response to the UK's vote to leave the EU, and just how little this government understands about business's response to the EU referendum. Because the thing about business is that it is very good at seeing opportunities and reframing the narrative to the positive. Whenever a business faces an unexpected challenge, they don't do what this Scottish government appears to do, which is talk of problems, economic shocks, dangers, warnings. They roll up their sleeves and look for opportunities. Only last week, in this very building, I was talking to a representative of a Scottish aquaculture business who's seen international exports rise substantially following the depreciation of the pound. Direct evidence of what the CBI reported in early August, when it found that Britain's SMEs are expected to boost exports by around 10% as a result of the UK's vote. And SMEs are now reporting the first improvement in competitiveness in EU and non-EU markets since 2013. Yes, I will.
Ms. Martin.
Would Mr. Kerr agree with me that basing a business model on the devaluation of the pound is possibly an only temporary thing and is not something to aspire to?
Mr. Kerr.
I wouldn't agree with that. Well, I'm not talking about basing a business model on depreciation of the pound. I'm reporting what the CBI were reporting about SMEs, and I'm talking about optimism, which is something that has been manifestly absent from the Scottish Government's position thus far. Indeed, the Scotch Whisky Association were claiming that there are exciting opportunities for the food and drink sector as they find new markets and as the UK becomes more competitive. We heard from Murdo-Fraser that the domestic tourist industry has had a great summer. And then there is the Scottish fishing industry, who believe that, quote, exit from the EU presents a unique opportunity for the UK to re-establish itself as a major fishing nation. Re-establish. The Common Fisheries Policy and European Commission interference has decimated the British fishing industry. In the space of just over three decades, the EU has taken a profitable, well-managed resource providing direct employment to 350,000 people in fishing and processing and providing 5.4 million jobs in the wider economy and nearly destroyed it. Please leave the Central Belt, come up and visit Macduff or Banff or White Hills or Port Soy and witness the devastation caused by mandated fleet reductions, cod recovery plans and quota cuts. Yes, sir.
Mr. Steeves, I thought you'd rise.
When he mentions Banff, I have to, presiding officer. I wonder if the member could answer two questions. How many of the last 30 years has there been a reduction in the value of landings at Peterhead? I'll give him the answer, three. Secondly, what has happened to the size of the Norwegian fleet that is outside the CFP over the period he refers to the Scottish fleet?
Mr. Kerr.
Yes, I thank Mr. Stevenson for his question. I can answer authoritatively on both of those points. However, given I've only got 6 minutes, I would encourage Stuart Stevenson to write in, and I promise I will give you a full answer that addresses all those points. Peterhead is a very particular answer, which I can answer, and I promise you that I will, Mr. Stevenson. So when the Scottish fishing industry claimed last week that, quote, exit from the EU presents a unique set of opportunities for Scotland to reinvigorate its coastal and island communities and deliver a thriving, profitable and sustainable seafood industry, when the industry says it offers opportunities and the freedom to explore new markets for seafood in rapidly expanding markets outside the EU, we hear negativity and fear from the SNP. But are we surprised? Are the fishermen of the Buchan Coast, of Shetland, of Mallaig surprised? No. For this is the party who promised Scotland's withdrawal from the common fisheries policy until they got into government and then dropped it, who ignored scientific advice and the pleas of the fishermen on the Clyde when enthusiastically implementing marine protected areas, who said nothing when the European Commission signed into law a regulation that allowed Faroese fishermen to catch more mackerel off Shetland than the island's own pelagic fleet. In December 2015, a vital vote took place in the European Fisheries Committee that, if passed, would have introduced cod into the discard ban a full 1 year earlier than planned, which would have been devastating for the fishing industry. You're quite right, Stuart Stevenson. I wasn't
Mr.
here for that
Stevenson,
last point.
Mr. Stevenson, would you like to intervene and see if it will be accepted rather than barracking?
No question. Mr. Stevenson is right. I wasn't here during that last point. I'm only new in. The SNP were not there in the European Fisheries Committee in December 2015. So it comes as no surprise that the Scottish Government has had nothing positive to say to the fishing industry and the huge opportunities open to it and other industries by the UK's vote to leave the EU. For years, they have hidden behind European regulations that they oppose in Buchan, but back in Brussels. It is time for the SNP to start acting in the interests of all Scotland's industries, and that means working with and as part of the UK. For all of these reasons, the motion as drafted simply cannot be supported. And I commend the amendment to the chamber.
Thank you, Mr. I now call Kate Forbes, followed by Jenny Mara. Ms. Forbes, please.
Thank you, presiding officer. And could I just start off the back of that last speech? As a constituency MSP with a lot of fishing in my area, I'd just like to quote Will McCallum, head of oceans at Greenpeace UK, who reminded us all that it's the Westminster government, not Brussels, who's in charge of allocating the EU-agreed fishing quota and who has chosen for years to give most of it to a handful of large corporations rather than to the smaller fishermen who have most to lose. And that's certainly been the impact in Mallaig. But to the subject at hand, between 2007 and 2013, the Highlands and Islands have benefited from tens of millions of pounds because we are, or were, or maybe will be, a member of the EU. That funding has directly been utilised to teach our children, build our roads, conserve our environment, and boost our businesses. I can be more specific. In my constituency of Skye, Lochaber and Badenoch, we've received 100 million between 2007 and 2013. And I can assure you that that figure of £100 million is not plucked from the sky, because I painstakingly went through every European funded project or initiative in my constituency between those years and counted every penny, and I didn't include the common agricultural payments. So for us, the impact of the EU has been local. It's been community-based language assistance, strategic employment projects. It's gone towards Skills Development Scotland to allow them to provide local training opportunities in the Highlands and Islands. It's gone towards projects in the Cairngorms. It's specifically provided £2.25 million for vital Highland roads like the A855 between Portree and Staffin. It's been grants of £20 million each to the University of the Highlands and Islands and Highlands and Islands Enterprise, because Brussels' impact can be as close as our front door. Now, in the interests of fairness, and touching on a point that Murdo raised, for a region which exports globally renowned food and drink, I did welcome the projected increase in export markets. And in for an incredibly hospitable region, which hosts thousands of tourists each year, I accept that we've seen a huge increase in visitors from the EU to the Highlands this year. But I would say to Murdo, who saw the benefits in my constituency, that most would probably have booked their holiday.
Could you use full names, please?
Murdo-Fraser, I apologise. Most would have booked their holiday prior to the referendum outcome. And surely it demonstrates to all of us that a free market for our exports and free movement for our visitors is critical to the future economy of the Highlands and Islands. Because in Scotland, we're proud of our brand and our popularity. We're proud of our food and drink exports, our university education. And in 2014, 42% or £11.6 billion of Scotland's international exports were to EU countries, with 6 out of 10 of Scotland's top 10 export destinations being members of the single market. We're proud too that people from the rest of the world choose to make their home in our cities and in our villages. The increase in EU membership in 2004 has helped improve stagnating Scottish immigration figures, with increases of around 0.5% year on year in the 11 years since. And that has ensured that many Scottish businesses, particularly in the Highlands and Islands, who struggle to recruit staff, have been able to fill vacancies within their organisations and been able to maintain full complements of staff and provide a service or goods in the Highlands and Islands. So, as somebody who passionately believes in Scotland's ability to succeed, I do have every faith in businesses across Scotland to flourish, whether we're inside or outside the European Union, because the EU is not the linchpin for success for the Scottish economy. But its great strength is as an enabler. It has enabled capital investment in rural areas like my constituency. It has enabled us to trade without barriers with our European cousins. It has enabled our young people to expand their horizons, and it has enabled our businesses to recruit and retain staff from across the EU in areas of Scotland which do struggle to find staff. And if the Conservative Party want to talk about the challenges to our economy, let me remind them that the Institute for Fiscal Studies estimates a negative shock of £24 to £39 billion to public finances by 2019-2020 as a result of Brexit. That the Fraser of Allender Institute reported that early signs of an improving outlook has been dented by a Brexit vote, and that the UK government has itself abandoned targets to achieve a surplus by 2019-2020 because of the Brexit vote. I could almost deal with it if it were a mess of our own making, but the tragedy in all of this is it wasn't this government's decision or this nation's decision to leave.
Thank you very much. Call Jenny Mara to be followed by Tom Arthur. Ms. Mara, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A journalist from the Toronto Globe and Mail was in Edinburgh last week. He gave a talk on the economies of Montreal and Toronto. He cited evidence that the economy of Montreal had faltered as a result of the two referendums in Quebec and has never properly recovered. During that time, Toronto took off and left Montreal in its economic wake. The journalist talked in detail about how the governing separatist party in Quebec spent money regularly, injecting the economy with announcements of pots of cash here and there, trying but ultimately failing to compensate for the poor economic and investment environment their overall political objective was creating. I was reminded acutely of the First Minister's cash injection of $100 million this summer, much heralded, repeated again here in her legislative statement, but as we all know, and the SNP should know, no compensation at all for the economic conditions that the independence referendum 2 years ago created. I'll take an intervention in a minute. The EU referendum, which added insult to injury, and the ongoing uncertainty and threat of a third referendum here in Scotland. I'll take the intervention now.
Cabinet Secretary.
Okay, I thank Jenny Mara for taking intervention and just point out to her that she says that investment flew away from Montreal, from Quebec, during the course of their referendums. Is she aware that in the 2014-15 and 2015-16, Ernst & Young demonstrate we had record inward investment in Scotland during those 2 years? Or is she unaware of that fact?
Sure, there is some record of inward investment. There is no doubt the reports overall over the last few years have created economic uncertainty. And the Cabinet Secretary has said himself today about the uncertainty that these referendums create. Now, the Tories know acutely well how Brexit has rocked confidence. Murdo-Fraser said so himself. And I imagine very much regret that they did not have a Prime Minister with more backbone than to bow to pressure from his Eurosceptics, whose votes he would to become Tory leader 10 years ago. He put party before country. I think the historians will judge him harshly for it, and rightly so. The global capital we refer to in the Labour amendment today will survive. It will fly away, as my colleague Richard-Leonard outlined. It will find a home in a more welcoming, calm and stable environment. But the real failure here is for the people who cannot and who do not want to fly away. Working people whose families and homes are here in Scotland but do not have the means or the want to up sticks and find a more prosperous economic climate. Opposite to the First Minister, their economic fears transcend constitutional arguments. I see this fear every day in the families in my region. Fear for their sons and daughters, their economic chances, and what paths they might go down if a job, an income, a house are not available to them. Uncertainty caused by two and maybe three referendums does not help this at all. And that is why, Presiding Officer, I am appalled at the woeful lack of imagination and focus on our economy from the Scottish Government. And I think that is clear from the motion and the opening speech today. The First Minister, in her legislative programme, briefly announced a strategy for decommissioning work from the oil and gas industry. This was very welcome, very tardy, but very welcome at last, nevertheless. Now, I understand there is a tight timescale for this and it is due to report in late October, November. Any clarification from this on the government benches would be useful today, but it is right to report soon, because the peak of the decommissioning market is predicted by industry to be in 2019. That's only 2 years from now. Is Scotland ready to harness these jobs here? I think the truth is that the government would like to say that we are, but they have not yet put in nearly enough work to assess our capacity and capabilities. And that's why we saw the Maersk platform sail off to Norway this summer. That's why Brent is being decommissioned in the northeast of England, sailing past unemployed engineers all the way down the east coast of Scotland, past the ports of Montrose, Dundee and Methil, to be taken apart where regional development authorities have had the foresight to secure this work. Apart from the moral imperative of sustainable jobs, there is another question of equity in this work. Decommissioning is and will be funded to the tune of 60% by the Scottish and UK taxpayer through tax relief. Taxpayers in my city and region have been paying for this work for years and will be for years to come. Is it right, therefore, that jobs directly funded by the British taxpayer go to Turkey and Norway? Would other countries be so utterly stupid as to let this happen? Now, Presiding Officer, given our Scottish Government's discomfort with the Scottish people paying tax to London, should they not be outraged that more is not being done by both governments to secure this work in our communities here in Scotland? I have not heard the First Minister utter one word on this, or indeed her Finance Secretary. I wonder why. Indeed, when I asked the Finance Secretary in this chamber last week if he had spoken about tax relief for decommissioning with the Treasury, he said it wasn't his job. Keith Brown, apparently, is liaising with the Treasury. Now, I have lodged a parliamentary question asking Keith Brown about this today, but if he'd like to answer on this now, I would be obliged.
It seems he will, Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, happy to do so. The discussions which Derek Mackay referred to were discussions which I had with the Chief Secretary to the Treasury to put the main ask of the industry, which was for loan guarantees for infrastructure work, which was well received, and I'm assured that the UK Government is going to take action on this much quicker than the 3 years that he talked about, in perhaps 3 or 4 months, so it was successful to that extent.
Well, I very much welcome that intervention from the Minister, and I will be writing to him for a bit more detail on that, if that is okay. Presiding Officer, yesterday I held a decommissioning summit meeting in Dundee to bring key stakeholders together to specifically discuss opportunities for our city. It was a very useful meeting with Forth Ports liaising with key players like Shell and AECOM to pin down details of opportunities for our port. I would very much like to see the government's economic agency doing detailed, localised work like this all over Scotland to really spur on economic possibilities. Because while the constitutional discussions rumble on, families in Dundee still worry about jobs for the future, while our future jobs sail to shores beyond the EU. Brexit or no Brexit, Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government should be getting on with the day job.
Thank you very much. Call Tom Arthur to be followed by Rachel Hamilton. Mr. Arthur, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to take this opportunity to inform the Chamber that the First Minister has appointed me as Parliamentary Liaison Officer to the Cabinet Secretary for Justice. I would also like to take this opportunity to welcome Michael Russell to his new position. His job is one that requires skill, both political and intellectual, matched with tenacity and determination. I'm sure that the Chamber would agree with me that in all these attributes, Mr. Russell is preeminent. Presiding Officer, this is the first opportunity I have had to address the Chamber since the United Kingdom voted to leave the European Union. I am proud that an overwhelming majority of people in Scotland, along with a majority in Northern Ireland, voted to reaffirm our bonds of solidarity and shared prosperity with the world's most important political and economic union of independent nation states. It is a matter of regret that we were not, however, able to persuade a majority of our friends and neighbours in England and Wales of the merit of our position. Consequently, we find ourselves in a situation not of our own making and quite unlike any other in modern British political history. As one who sincerely and honestly believes that Scotland's long-term interests would be best assured by assuming the responsibilities of statehood, I naturally feel a great sense of unfairness that both I and my constituents in Renfrewshire South now face being stripped of our European citizenship as a consequence of a decision taken out with Scotland. However, for those who share in this disappointment, our frustration must be tempered by the acceptance that this was a decision taken collectively by the United Kingdom, which Scotland, for now at least, remains a part of. Therefore, the immediate task we face in this place is to obtain the best outcome for Scotland and to maximise Scotland's participation in the UK negotiations as a member state. It is, I would proffer, axiomatic that the best outcome for Scotland is that the UK as a whole retains continued membership of what is commonly understood as a single market, i.e. the internal market of the European Union as defined by the four fundamental freedoms. Retaining full membership of the single market is of vital importance in realising what I hope is our shared ambition for the increased internationalisation of Scotland's economy. This key strategic objective is surely best achieved through continuing membership of the single market. Outside of the single market, we lose not only direct access to a market of over 500 million people, we also lose the clout and trade expertise of an institution which can parlay as an equal with both the United States and China. While the other countries of these islands will continue to be important trading partners, we must continue to expand our horizons and not allow our ambitions to be bounded or confined to trade dominated by the nations with whom we share this Atlantic archipelago. Presiding Officer, although the UK is now set to leave the European Union, this does not preclude the possibility of continuing membership of the single market. This could potentially be achieved through UK membership of the European Economic Area, as membership of EFTA in conjunction with bilateral agreements, or perhaps through a new bespoke set of treaties. While all such options merit serious consideration, what there does seem to be little prospect of is the UK enjoying continued membership of the single market without acceptance of the four fundamental freedoms, including freedom of movement. It is therefore with concern that when now being faced with this reality, it appears that the UK government is edging towards surrendering the UK's membership of the single market so as to substantially reduce the intake of migrants upon whom our future prosperity and the sustainability of our public services depend. Presiding Officer, the prospect of withdrawal from the single market, coupled with denying access to those who would seek to come and contribute to this country, would at best be a gross abdication of economic responsibility, and at worst, potentially the greatest act of self-inflicted harm committed by a British government since the Suez debacle. Therefore, we must do all we can to persuade the UK government not to pursue this reckless course. It is incumbent upon all members in this place that we give effect to the will of the Scottish people as expressed on June 23rd. This means pushing the UK government to demonstrate that it too respects the clearly expressed wish of the Scottish people. If unwilling to secure and ensure continued single market membership for the UK as a whole, then the UK government must strain every sinew to secure continued membership for Scotland, perhaps via some form of reverse Greenland or one country, two systems model. This would require an unprecedented boldness of vision, but would demonstrate a willingness to make the UK a genuine partnership of equals. Presiding Officer, it should be evident to all that this is a debate of the gravest importance, both to the future of Scotland and indeed to the United Kingdom. Unfortunately, however, it appears from over the summer we've seen a UK government that is asleep at the wheel, with Tory members in this place and in Westminster muttering somnolent drivel about empire, the world being our oyster, and even calling for the recommissioning of the Royal Yacht Britannia. While the UK government may not know what Brexit means, we in this Parliament must take our opportunity to define what it will mean for Scotland. In my view, that means retaining full and uninterrupted access and membership, crucially, membership of the single market. Should the UK government deliver, they will have demonstrated a willingness to treat Scotland as an equal partner. Should they fail, then it may not just be one union that they lose.
Okay, thank you. Call Rachel Hamilton, followed by Patrick Harvey. Ms Hamilton, please.
Deputy Presiding Officer, as Murdo-Fraser stated, the front page of the Sunday Herald may point out why confidence in Scottish businesses is not recovering like elsewhere in the UK. For the front page of the paper quoted the First Minister, the case for self-government ultimately transcends the issues of Brexit, of oil, of national wealth and balance sheets, and of passing political fads and trends. When the UK decided to leave the European Union, the SNP government took that as an opportunity to revisit a constitutional question that, as we, as a nation, had already settled. It is clear for all to see the uncertainty that comes with constantly questioning Scotland's place in the United Kingdom and not accepting the result of referenda. We must remember that domestic trade with the rest of the UK is worth four times more than that of with the EU. What sort of message is Nicola Sturgeon giving to our country? Let us not forget about our current economic situation. Scotland stands at a crossroads. Our economy is not matching that of the UK growth. Falling global oil prices haven't helped. The construction industry is struggling, and Scotland has a £15 billion deficit. If Scotland had become independent, every woman and child and man would be £1,600 worth off. That simply cannot be ignored. Professor Michael Keating, the director of the Economic and Social Research Council Centre on Constitutional Change, has warned that free trade between Scotland and the rest of the UK would end if one nation was in the EU single market and the other was not. Independence would ultimately lead to an economic barrier, a barrier to free movement, a barrier to goods and probably services as well. I haven't got very far, but yes, I will, Gillian Martin.
Ms. Martin.
Would that mean that if we're not in the EU, we can't trade with anyone in the EU? Because I'm getting a mixed message here.
I'm talking about what Michael Keating suggested, and this particularly refers to the domestic market. As Liam Kerr said, we will need to show the same resilience as we move forward into the unknown. Maintaining current relationships or developing new ones within Europe and the wider world will require skill and tenacity. The process will also require intensive government intervention and support. In this regard, the Scottish and the UK government must work closely together to help deliver what is best for Scotland and best for the United Kingdom as a whole. It is now time for the Scottish Government to look ahead and do right for Scottish business. We've heard from Murdo-Fraser the damage that business rates are causing, and indeed the damage of repeating the same constitutional questions. We could, however, be focusing on how to help Scottish business. If we take the tourism sector, for example, here we have a sector that has reported a boost since Brexit, as already mentioned. It is a sector that we should focus on and to encourage continued growth. Tourism is the buzzword on everybody's lips and is of vital importance to the Scottish economy. Spending by tourists in Scotland generates around £12 billion of economic activity in the wider Scottish supply chain and contributes around £6 billion to the Scottish GDP. This represents about 5% of the total Scottish GDP. A strong visitor economy helps to position Scotland on the world stage. The economic impact of visitor spend spreads out from the traditional component parts of the tourism industry into other sectors such as arts and crafts, food and drink, cultural activities, sports events and retail. There are around 14,000 tourism-related enterprises in Scotland. Job creation has been steady. Employment in the tourism-related industry sector accounts for 7.7% of employment in Scotland. However, we are experiencing a skills shortage, and this, according to the Federation of Small Businesses, is one of the biggest threats to the tourism business. EU migrants currently make up a large proportion of the tourism sector, and future workforce planning will be key to ensuring the success of this industry. Perhaps by bringing more of our own school leavers into this sector and helping employment growth, we can make some progress. We must look forward to the future, identify future problems, or just listen to Scottish businesses. What do they tell us? Business rates are causing insurmountable pain to many. There is a skills gap due to college places being cut. And there is an unwillingness to invest in Scottish businesses because the Scottish Government persists on revisiting the same constitutional questions. These are all problems that the Scottish Government can fix. Stop increasing rates. Stop cutting college places and stop revisiting these questions. Yeah. To conclude, the Scottish Government must work closely with the UK Government to identify what kind of European legislation might work for businesses. Let's drop what doesn't work and let's pick up what does. We need to be clear about how legislation will impact not just on tourism but all industries. This will require many more meetings between David Davis and Mike Russell as we move towards an exit that suits our nation as a whole.
Thank you. I call Patrick Harvey, followed by Gillian Martin. Mr. Harvey.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I may be wrong, but I think I heard nation singular at the end of that speech there. I must be mistaken. I'll check the official report tomorrow. Can I welcome this debate and also welcome the central argument in the government's motion that a change of UK economic policy is urgently needed to support the economy and our people instead of yet deeper austerity. The decision that was made on June 23rd will have profound consequences. Whatever happens over the months and years ahead, the willfully dishonest Leave campaign and the utter lack of preparedness within the UK government can only exacerbate those consequences. Now, the nature of the consequences is not yet clear, as indeed the Fraser of Allender Institute told us the other week. But perhaps the most immediately obvious impacts will be on those people who've exercised their right to move within the single market. Over many years, there's been an ongoing debate about the benefits and costs of immigration to our economy. And like most members of this Parliament, I've always been convinced that the net effect is clearly positive. Yes, for our economy, but also for our people. The ugly tendency for many in politics and the media to manipulate this issue with racism and xenophobia has been shameful. But the objective evidence about the economic benefits has only grown clearer. There have undoubtedly been stresses and pressures, those felt most keenly, in fact, by the very people who are forced to move in desperate circumstances, far more so than those pressures are felt by people living safely in the UK. But aside from economic impacts, migration is not something unnatural. It is a human norm, always has been part of our story. The failure to plan and invest in the housing, services and infrastructure that's needed is a failure of government, made dramatically worse by the UK's austerity policies. Now, the impact of Brexit on many people is clear. The first example in modern times of a political decision which has left so many people uncertain about where they will even be allowed to live. The impact on our economy is not yet clear. Our public services, our universities and industry all depend on the ability to attract talent and to make use of people's creativity and energy. And overwhelmingly, we know that those people are more highly educated than most of the population, less likely to claim tax credits, benefits, or indeed to live in social housing than the rest of the population. And bizarrely, there are still people on the right of the political spectrum who insist that the UK can be part of a single market while simultaneously demolishing one of its essential pillars, free movement. For most people, their labour, selling their labour and using their spending power, these are the main things that people can trade in a market. And if you're not free to move within a territory, then that territory cannot be described as a single market. Now, we, most of us here, might agree that it's desirable, even essential, to retain full access to that market. But the reality is that we have very little say. Just as Scotland's view has been overridden in the referendum result itself, the new reckless faction of hard Brexiteers on the Tory benches at Westminster have no interest in what we've got to say about the value to Scotland of retaining access and membership of the single market. They are pursuing a fundamental structural change in the UK's economic relationship with the rest of the world, and lacking any evidence base for their position, all they have left to fall back on is their own hard-right ideology with an added tinge of post-colonial entitlement. Yes, indeed.
Keith Brown.
Can I thank Patrick Harvey for taking intervention? I entirely agree with his description of the hard Brexiteers in the UK government. Will he now acknowledge that the Scottish Tories are now joined those hard Brexiteers, given Murdo-Fraser's statement that he does not believe it's essential to remain part of the single market, we should only have access to it?
Patrick Harvey.
Indeed. If I've saved myself enough time, I'll come on to the Conservatives' contribution to the debate in a moment or two. Now, this group, the hard Brexiteers, may only be one group within the Tory ranks, but the UK government itself, the front bench, is giving no clarity about what it's even seeking to achieve. The defenders of that government have claimed that it shouldn't be expected to show its hand before the negotiations begin. This isn't about showing its hand, it's simply about naming the game. What does a win even look like? What are they seeking to achieve? Now, the Scottish government is in a difficult position. I respect that and recognise it. But it is going to be clear, whatever comes down the line from the autumn budget statement, that Scottish government responses with devolved powers are also going to be necessary to protect investment in housing, in the infrastructure programme such as the energy efficiency programme. In wide general access to public services and public sector pay will also have an impact on economic activity. Private sector investment uncertainty is a huge barrier to that, but it also needs ethical context. And the Scottish Growth Fund could contribute to that, not just by offering a free-for-all, but by giving specific support to the kind of businesses that we want to see grow in Scotland. And we're also going to need to have a more creative approach to taxation than the Scottish Government has yet set out. The emphasis in the government motion is not quite as we might have written it in the Greens, and Labour's call for further action in their amendment isn't specific. We might have different ideas about what that further action might be, but on balance, both of these positions have much to commend them, and we'll be supporting both. On the Tory amendment, in closing, Deputy Presiding Officer, there are three main points, it seems. First of all, echoing the eternal whining for lower taxation. Despite decades of continual cuts to corporate taxation, now businesses shouldn't be expected to pay their local taxes either. Secondly, returning to their obsession with the Constitution and the blinkered desire to prevent Scottish voters from even considering the option of independence. And thirdly, utterly abandoning any credit that Ruth Davison gained during the Brexit debate. One minute, the Scottish Tories are facing down Boris and the Brexiteers, predicting Leave as a disaster, and now they've rolled over, ignoring their own convictions about Scotland's interests. Murdo-Fraser accuses the Scottish Government of sitting on the sidelines. Well, if all that government was doing was sitting back and letting Brexit roll over us, I would have no confidence in them. But while there is still a chance to protect Scotland's place in Europe, our economy's access to the single market, the Scottish Greens will continue to hold the Scottish Government to its duty to do all that it can.
Gillian Martin, followed by Alexander Burnett.
When surveyed in the month before the EU referendum, 76.5% of Aberdeen and Grampian Chamber of Commerce respondents said they would vote to remain in the EU. And if Britain left the EU, around 40% of respondents believed that there would be a negative impact on their company's profitability and their import-export strategies. Many feared the impact on staffing if they no longer had the labour pool produced by the freedom of movement. And a report produced by the Chamber last month stated, and I quote, "The prevailing theme is a request for clarity on the political and constitutional process of Brexit. And if Mr. Fraser wants an answer to this so-called lack of confidence, I suggest that that's it." Right now, those businesses, of course, have no option but to carry on with the day-to-day operations in an already challenging economic climate. But as Richard-Leonard pointed out, that when the impact does hit, the people who feel it first and most keenly will be the people in employment of those businesses. The principals of the two universities of Aberdeen, which are world leaders in research and innovation around energy, ecology and bioscience, are heavily dependent on EU and international funding, and in turn providing skills resources and generating opportunities for many of the companies in those fields in the Northeast, and they're moving heaven and earth to minimise the already worrying impact of the Brexit decision. And that's before the EU funding's even withdrawn. Already, our universities are finding themselves left out of future plans for collaborative research across the globe. Yes, not just from collaborations with their EU partners, but their global partners. Both universities generate millions of pounds for the Northeast economy, and a lot of this is a result of EU membership through grant support, which funds much of their work, or the EU talent that make up their teaching, research, and student body, who also live in the area. And frankly, the decision to leave any Scottish universities out of the post-study visa pilot, work visa pilot, is scandalous and compounds the damage potential of Brexit. Outside the city, we're of course in the middle of harvest time, but many growers, particularly in soft fruit, will be wondering if they can rely on up to the 1,500 EU nationals who are employed seasonally to pick and pack the fruit as years progress. Issues around workforce similarly affect the hospitality sector, and I'm interested to hear Rachel suggest that perhaps EU nationals be replaced by people by school pupils. And of course, my friend and colleague Stuart Stevenson has mentioned the issues with Northeast fish processors, one of which is in my constituency in Mintlaw, who rely on EU nationals who work there to satisfy their orders and business. And it's also estimated that 50% of meat processing workers are from outside the UK. Not only are these people facilitating our industries, they're also paying income tax and spending their money locally. Where are the guarantees to the current UK taxpayers who may be forced to leave if freedom of movement becomes a thing of the past? Where is the evidence of the so-called opportunities that the leader of these Tory benches now suddenly thinks are out there when she previously spoke so passionately against leaving the EU? And I must confess, I'm not convinced by the new script handed to the Tory benches by the new boss. It's somewhat at odds with the majority of their contributions to the EU debate in early June. And if those opportunities are solely because of a temporary reduction in the value of the pound due to the money market shock at our decision in June, well, I'm going to need a bit more persuading on the long-term value of these so-called opportunities. And it's a little like saying the devaluation of the German mark in the 1920s Weimar Republic was good for suitcase and wheelbarrow salesmen. And I'm going to make this point, and I'm going to make it strongly. In 2012, when constitutional change was up for discussion and a referendum vote, the SNP government published a 700-page blueprint outlining how we saw Scotland operating after the yes vote. And for many of our opponents, that still wasn't detailed enough. Yet when asked to vote in 2016's constitutional decision of a seismic magnitude, the public had nothing in print to refer to about how a post-Brexit Britain might work. Slogans on buses don't count, apparently. And now in the aftermath, there's still nothing that gives our public services, businesses, education sector and citizens any idea of what Brexit will actually mean economically. And what now that we're in this situation that Scotland didn't vote for and that nearly every parliamentarian across the parties in this chamber spoke against? Well, it would appear that it falls to the Scottish Government to roll out economic stimulus packages as evidenced in the Cabinet Secretary's speech. It's time for Westminster to step up to the plate and take their economic responsibility for Scotland seriously and do the same. Inform us of and involve us in the detail of any negotiations to guarantee our business access to EU markets. Guarantee our workforce will not be stripped of the thousands of EU nationals, and provide our world-class and local economy-powering educational establishments the promises they need to reassure their partners, students and staff that they have stability beyond 2020. Because at the moment, it feels a little bit like the Tories have crashed our car and are now sending us the bill for the damage.
Alexander Burnett, followed by Stuart Stevenson.
I thank the Deputy Presiding Officer for the opportunity to speak on Scotland's economy and how it responds to the EU referendum. Firstly, it is important to note that Scotland voting to remain did not at any point give the SNP any right to hold a second referendum on Scotland's independence. And by their action now, the SNP are putting Scottish energy firms on the back foot with dwindling levels of foreign investment compared to the rest of the UK. Whilst not everyone in the United Kingdom may have been happy with the result, we must start making a success of Brexit. The SNP need to realise that Brexit is a great opportunity for our energy sector. From creating a specific flexible energy system to being freed from the shackles of EU energy directives, the Scottish Government should be ready to support an industry ready to grow and welcome the opportunities ahead.
Patrick Harvey.
I'd be interested if the member could give examples of specific EU energy directives he wants ripped up.
Alexander Burnett.
Thank you. Oh, maybe I should have waited before giving away. Whilst the North East is a global hub of oil and gas companies, it is just that, global. And for many companies in Aberdeen, the North Sea provides only a fraction of their business, and a weaker pound has greatly assisted export revenues. Take Balmoral Offshore Engineering, a company I visited only a month ago, where 90% of its business in buoyancy and insulation products are exported to emerging markets as far afield as South America. And it is essential that we seize this break for our export market and allow them to boost our Scottish economy, in dire need of investment after 9 years of SNP rule. And I can only hope, unlike fracking, that this is an opportunity the Scottish Government won't miss. Now, Brexit also gives us the opportunity to rid ourselves of overreaching EU policymakers and preventing our remote communities from getting their specific energy requirements as a result of breaching state aid rules. Now, currently, the UK government is unable to target our Scottish islands with specific energy policies, as they contradict energy market rules set by Brussels. The opportunity of Brexit gives us the chance to create a tailored Scottish energy system, where we can ensure all Scottish consumers get reliable, clean and affordable energy. Bureaucratic EU procurement laws also mean that we can't favour Scottish energy companies for contracts. Instead, we force our companies to compete with a continent where other countries still support state enterprises and have a very different view to state aid rules. Rules that, even when broken, are proved so long after the fact that the damage has already been done. Now, on energy security, another key point to make is that whilst we may have left the EU, we certainly haven't left Europe. Our energy security does not rely on our membership of the single market either. We haven't hauled up our anchors and sailed away. Quite the opposite, for we are tethered to the continent through a vast series of interconnectors. A majority of these in the North Sea connect us to Norway, one of our major energy suppliers and a non-EU member. And a clear demonstration of the lack of reliance the UK has on the EU for energy demand. And I would also welcome the plan for a further interconnector with Iceland, a country of 300,000 people, again, a country thriving outside of EU energy directives.
Mike Rumbles.
I'm a little confused with his argument. I just wanted to make it, could you make it clear, are you as an individual in favour of remaining in the single market, or your argument seems to be saying that we should be leaving it? Which is it?
Alexander Burnett.
I think that question's already been answered earlier by my colleague Murdo-Fraser. It's not the membership of a single market which is important, it is the access to the single market which is important, and that is the basis for which we will be negotiating. And I would have thought if the Scottish Government got on board with that and ensured we had the best access to whether it be energy or other goods or products or services, we would be stronger cooperating with all parts of the United Kingdom. But on a more global issue, such as climate change, whilst our Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee has raised the question of Brexit several times, not once has it been suggested that the goals for the forthcoming climate change bill will be lowered by recent events. Our climate change goals will not change. They are enshrined at a national level rather than an EU level, and we should be proud of the progress we have made. On a more topical source of energy, given recent events, the SNP will also be pleased to hear that our main supplier of imported shale gas, America, is also a non-EU member. My only displeasure with this trade is that it is coming at the cost of Scottish jobs and our economy. INEOS, who operate the Grangemouth plant, will celebrate the first shale gas shipment arriving in Scotland next week. They say shale gas has helped safeguard the future of the plant and created new jobs and investment. However, the Scottish Government have snubbed the event, prompting suspicions it doesn't want to be associated with fracking. This is a childish approach that wouldn't be replicated across the world, and it's time for nationalists to recognise the value of shale. Now, whilst a weak pound is good for our exports and manufacturing businesses, it is certainly not the time to be spending hard-earned foreign exchange on fuel we could be producing here. It is clear when it comes to the United Kingdom's balance of payments, the SNP would rather put self-interest before the economic interests of a country. I think we can all see now the SNP will only see Brexit as an opportunity for self-interest and never for the opportunity Scotland's economy demands. It is vitally important that the SNP start to make Scotland a global leader in energy and put their ideological need for a further independence referendum to bed. Thank you.
Stuart Stevenson, followed by David Stewart.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and let me just pick up a couple of points that have arisen so far, in particular Liam Kerr. And let me start with a point of agreement with Liam Kerr, just to set a favourable tone. Change is certainly opportunity for those who have the energy and the ideas, but it also is a challenge which we also have to respond to. And that's always the case, whatever the nature of change. So at least I start with that agreement. I'm just going to briefly, however, pick up the point that the government has never said anything about the Faroes and the fishing. 10th of August 2010, Richard Lochhead condemned Icelandic Faroes. parliamentary answer, the 10th of February 2012. Just, I'll give you the number so you can write it down. S4W05594. To Jean Urquhart, no access to Faroese waters, regrettable. 2014, the First Minister met the Faroese Prime Minister to discuss the subject. 9th of December 2015, Richard Lockhead said the fisheries deal in relation to Faroes is unacceptable. If I'd had as much time researching his false claim as I've spent rebutting it, I could have come up with a 1,000-page book, I suspect. No, he will not, because he's now going to move on to Murdo-Fraser. Murdo-Fraser made reference to state aid rules, and of course, he's correct. If you're outside the EU, then the state aid rules of the EU are not binding upon the UK, and that's probably fair comment. However, abandoning the state aid rules is not without pain if you wish to trade with the EU. You will find that you're unable to do so. But also, let me pick up the point that's emerged in the debate. Having access to the single market or being member of the single market. And in particular, I use Switzerland as an example that has access to the single market, but is not a member of the single market. Now, what that actually means in practice is they can trade in goods across the border, by and large, but there's significant restrictions on access for agricultural goods, very little access for professional services, and virtually no access for financial services. Now, that's not a trivial matter. 12% of the UK economy is financial services. It's 12% of the economic output of the UK. So in considering whether we should be a member or merely have access, don't imagine they equate to each other. There are choices that can be made. That's perfectly proper, but they are not the same thing, and Switzerland tells us that. I've been talking about banking. I should also just declare that I voluntarily said in my register of interests I have shares in Lloyds Bank below the declarable limit. I want to talk a bit about the area that I represent, Aberdeenshire Council and Moray Council in my constituency. A study that Aberdeenshire Council undertook suggests that there might be £11 million at risk. And I think that will be repeated across Scotland in different ways, in particular the North East Scotland Fisheries Local Action Group through the European Maritime and Fisheries Fund are likely to lose money. And the North East farming sector receives between £75 and £100 million in EU subsidies. They appear to be guaranteed for some period of time, but the long term is very uncertain indeed. I want to talk a little bit about technology generally and how leaving the EU and being outside the European single market might affect them. In particular, the Unitary Patent Court. At the moment, if you wish to register a patent in the EU, you can do so once. Outside the EU, outside the Unitary Patent Court, which is a creature of the EU, you're going to have to register your patents 38 times. That's a significant burden on innovation in Scotland, which of course invented most of the modern world, but in the UK as a whole. And of course, we will have far less influence over patent law. We'll also be shutting ourselves off from the European digital single market, which provides data protection, better access to products and services at reduced costs, and is driving acceptance and innovation of digital services by setting pan-European standards. For example, the debate around the prospect of 5G mobile phone communications. That's important to Scotland. It's important to the UK. And some constituencies are going to be more effective than others, it's fair to say. A constituency, for example, that has the headquarters of Tesla Motors in the EU, is the headquarters to Hutchison 3G, Informatica, Adobe, who are products that we use every day, and Quest Software, and a huge number of others. Now, where are these particular companies? They're in Maidenhead, which those of you who may know a little bit about it is the constituency that the Prime Minister represents. I hope that when she sits down with these companies and looks at the problems that innovators and technology companies are going to experience as a result of the policy that her government has put in place, they will find that she is challenged. I hope that leads to her realising that we have to minimise the adverse impact of leaving the EU by ensuring that we do stay, not simply having access to the single market, but as members of the single market. And finally, Presiding Officer, a survey of 1,000 Europeans working in the UK by Total Jobs suggests 25% of them are prepared to reconsider career options outside the UK. Another hammer blow if we don't have free movement of people. Presiding Officer.
David Stewart to be followed by Tavish Scott.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and could I welcome Mike Russell to his new post, and I wish him well in this negotiation with Westminster. Whatever side, Presiding Officer, we are in the Brexit argument, there is one issue that unites both sides of this debate, that the referendum result has thrown the UK into deep and uncharted waters. No complete member state has ever left the EU, the world's largest single market with 550 million people, where 50% of the UK's exports are sold tariff-free with no trade barriers. Even, Presiding Officer, the ancient Highland mystic, the Bran Seer, would struggle to predict the economic health of Scotland and the UK post-Brexit. And former US Secretary of State Donald Rumsfeld famously talked about known knowns. What do we know about Brexit and what are the known knowns? Well, there's not a lot, Presiding Officer. We know about, of course, Article 50 of the Lisbon Treaty, the section which allows a member state to leave the EU. It seems to me to have been drafted as an afterthought to a redundant section which was never designed to be used. We also know that only the UK can invoke the article for our country, that there will not be a vote in the Commons prior to invoking the article. There's no evidence that I can see of a second referendum, notwithstanding the petition of more than 4 million people who have signed calling for one, nor any evidence of an early general election. Now, Article 50 specifies that all other 27 countries in the EU will negotiate with the state that is leaving and has up to 2 years, unless extended, to sort out trade negotiations. And one trade negotiation I just want to highlight, Presiding Officer, is the EU internal market, which formalises restrictions on productions and protects geographic indication. As you would guess, I've got a local issue, which is that Stornoway black pudding is protected by this designation. And clearly, if we leave, the protection for excellent Stornoway black pudding and indeed whisky in America, which is also protected by this designation, would fall. Once the timetable has expired, the default trade position is that we rely on basic World Trade Organization agreements. And the World Trade Organization chief executive, Roberto Axvido, said in The Guardian back in May this year that Brexit would bring back trade barriers of £9 billion a year to British consumers. He went on to say that the UK will be forced to negotiate trade deals with all 161 World Trade Organization members, akin to joining from scratch. And he said in a quote, Presiding Officer, the consumer in the UK will have to pay these duties. The UK is not in a position to decide I'm not charging duties here. That is impossible. That is illegal. So how realistic is the two-year timescale for Brexit? Well, let's look at a comparison. The Comprehensive Economic and Trade Agreement, CETA, between the EU and Canada is a negotiated and bilateral agreement which has been on the table for, wait for it, 7 years and is still not in force. But I'd like to focus in the remaining minutes, Presiding Officer, on the impact of Brexit on the Highlands and Islands, my region. Now, historically, Presiding Officer, the Highlands and Islands has faced economic and social challenges, depopulation, lower economic activity than the rest of Scotland, seasonality, peripherality, poor transport and infrastructure, and loss of young people. Now, only recently has this been reversed, and the EU regional territorial cohesion policies have been the key transformation agent. Now, Highlands and Islands are Scotland's only transition region, And whilst the main worry to me is the loss of European structural and investment funds, there are other concerns in the horizon I'd like to flag up as well, Presiding Officer. The loss of Interreg, the loss of Horizon 2020, the loss of COSME, which is the business support, and the loss of Erasmus Plus. Can the Minister in the wind-up confirm if the funds allocated to ESIF will survive once the funds are repatriated through the co-financing objectives? At present, the emphasis on regional policy that takes into account the different challenges that affect regions like Hans and Islands just isn't just in place across the UK, and it's only through funding support and policies from the EU that factors like population and workforce planning, communications, distance from markets, and the higher cost of doing business in remoter areas has been addressed. President Officer, I'm concerned that unless the impact of the EU support and policies to Hans Islands are truly recognised and understood, Brexit will have a calamitous impact on the future economic growth of the region. Now, of course, I understand that some may argue, what has Europe ever done for us in the Highlands and Islands? Well, I would say, look at the funding for the University of the Highlands Islands. Look at the funding for the European Marine Energy Centre in Orkney, the funding for the Marine Centre in Oban, the Department of Lithodonics in Inverness, ferry terminals in Stornoway, Scrubter and Stromness, the Western Isles Spinal Route, air terminals, business support, and let's not forget the Keswick Bridge. Losing the support and finance of the EU will not be made even more bruising to the region if Scotland loses access to the single market. Now, the Highlands and Islands, as members will all know, is a significant exporter to the rest of Europe, particularly in the nation's excellent food and drink sector, most notably whisky and seafood. Having to pay for access to the market will cause Scotland to lose our competitive edge and lead to the loss of much investment. And certainly around issues like these are already having an impact in investments, with many plans being proposed or cancelled altogether. I think the Cabinet Secretary referred to the High Report, which flagged up that very point. And additionally, the work of CAP can't be underestimated to the Highlands and Islands economy, with so many people in the region reliant on agriculture, both directly and indirectly. In conclusion, I believe this is the most important issue for the future of the Scottish economy. The pathway ahead is not clear, but in the words of the celebrated codebreaker, Alan Turing, we can only see a short distance ahead, but we see plenty of things there that need to be done. Thank you.
Tavish Scott, followed by Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This is the second Brexit debate in a week, and we're due another one next week, I'm told, as well. And I've been puzzling as to why that would be, but it occurred to me just now, because I see Mike Russell's going to respond on behalf of the government today. I feel a bit sorry for Mike Russell, because there's no process yet in place, and there is, of course, no negotiating position yet to negotiate on. So they've decided to fill poor Mike Russell's diary with endless debates about Brexit. I think we'll have to bring Jamie McGregor back and debate Nephrops and Brexit before very long. Keith Brown started during his remarks today by challenging the Chamber to come up with some ideas and proposals around what would be helpful for the Scottish economy, which I thought was an entirely fair charge. So four things came to me as he offered that challenge to Parliament this afternoon. The first is the report that the Fraser of Allender Institute published last week, which for all of us, irrespective of where we are in the political spectrum, must be the most seminal piece of research done on public spending in recent years. And it suggests that we face, by 2021, a 1.6 billion or 6% cut in public spending. And they suggest that one of those areas may be local authorities, who could face a cut of £1 billion again in their spending over the next number of years. So my first suggestion to the government would be to publish even a draft budget, because one of the aspects that all businesses, the voluntary sector and local authorities who need to ensure they look to the future number of years in how they can react to both the public spending squeeze we face, but also the economic circumstances that will at some stage be caused by Brexit, would be to have a budget not left to the last minute, as I fear we may be heading for, but instead published in very short order indeed, and I'd encourage the government to do that. The second is to take up Jenny Marr's point about decommissioning. The only point I disagreed with Jenny Marr on was that there were options for Brent. One of them was Lerwick, and they bypassed that, as she rightly said, to take those
oil, or they're currently taking some of those top sides down to Teesside. From my point of view, at least those jobs are in the UK. She made a fair point about Maersk going to Norway. What I'd hope the Cabinet Secretary, the Economy Cabinet Secretary, might again stress to the Treasury is he made a fair point about the importance of loan guarantees, in which I agree with. But I, like Jenny Marr, want to see tax relief that is provided to the oil and gas sector tied to the jobs being held in the UK. Now, I'd like them all in Lerwick, Jenny would like them in Dundee, we'd all like them at least in our country. And I hope the Cabinet Secretary will take that as a second example. The third example is on fishing. Now, a number of members have raised that. The only point I disagree with Stuart Stevenson on that is he cited all these PQs and various other things about the Faroese. The Faroese won that argument, as he well knows. So we all lost that one. And it doesn't matter, the UK government and the Scottish government were in the same place on that. And that is one of the reasons the Scottish fishing industry and the pelagic industry in particular detest the common fisheries policy and don't have a lot of time for the European Union as well. So for my other suggestion on this to the government is that I believe they need to instruct civil servants to move ahead with a new fisheries policy for Scotland. They need to do the same for agriculture as well, because one way or another, we're going to have a different kind of agriculture policy. And I hope that they would take up this challenge of however many years we may now have before this comes to fruition, to work on that, because I suspect many of us across politics would agree about the need for something very different than we've got at the moment. My final example is on developing Scotland's young workforce. If there is something I want to see in this Parliament, it is that we value the vocational routes into work as business want, as Ian Wood's commission made so clear 3 years ago. We value their vocational routes into work and embed that in schools at a much earlier stage than always the pursuit of academic performance and academic statistics, and in other words, the pursuit of just an academic route into work. So that would be my other suggestion for the government, because I fear that now that they have mainstreamed, to use that terrible word we all use, that spending, there will not be the same focus around developing Scotland young workforce as when Sir Ian Wood produced that report, and the government rightly took it forward. The final suggestion I've got for Mr Brown, I suspect one he will not take up, is I also think he should drop any suggestion of bringing back a second referendum on independence. I don't think that would be helpful. Business doesn't believe it would be helpful, and what we could do is as much stability as we could possibly have in Scotland to contrast with the uncertainty we've got south of the border. Now, Murdo-Fraser, I must confess, all the Tory speeches today have sounded even more Eurosceptic than the last lot. But Murdo-Fraser cited a study that said everything's fine. I have to say to him that the Chartered Management Institute, and I have to confess I hadn't heard of the Chartered Management Institute, but I'm sure it's a very learned body, produced a report which was published yesterday, in which they cited that most bosses, this is across the whole of the UK, predicted slowing growth over the next 12 to 18 months. Only a third of those bosses saw Brexit as paving the way to better times over the next 3 to 5 years. And the chief executive of this Chartered Management Institute said, "Brexit uncertainty has made many managers deeply anxious about growth, finance and access to talent from EU countries." Well, I think we need to get some balance into that, and that is supported by Highlands Science Enterprises survey of companies. Other David Stewart's just mentioned the importance of business in the Highlands and Islands. I would accord with that view. Their findings of their latest survey of major companies in the Highlands and Islands show that 55% of businesses said the result, i.e. the Brexit vote, made them feel less confident in the future of the Scottish economy. So for every study that are cited from the Conservative benches saying the world's wonderful and there's huge opportunities, there are far more from business, not from those of us who may actually believe in the European Union, but from business saying this is not the best way to be. And I just want to finish, if I may, Deputy Presiding Officer, with Theresa May in New York today. Last night, I read, she met Wall Street bankers to try and convince them that Brexit, whatever Brexit means to the Prime Minister today, will not mean that they should leave the City of London. As I've tried to argue before, I think the City of London is the most important aspect in the UK sense of why this is so damaging for the future of the UK and for the future of Scotland. And the fact that the Prime Minister had to spend time drinking wine with city bankers in New York last night, for me, says it all.
Stuart McMillan, followed by Edward Mountain.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Presiding Officer, a key element of our continued relationship with the EU must be to remain as a member of the EU single market, and today's debate has certainly underlined the importance of that. But getting the right deal for Scotland in circumstances not of our choosing must be the shared aim of every single MSP and everyone in the country. Yet almost 3 months have passed since the result of the referendum, and yet we still have got no idea whether or not the UK government actually wishes to remain within the single market. Now, I think there's a vital point that's not been highlighted often enough in this debate, and that is, although we've had the referendum, we've had the result of the referendum, Brexit has not yet happened. So no matter what analysis has been published, and no matter what we've heard today from the Conservative benches, Brexit has not yet happened, so we have not yet got the full implications, economic implications, for Scotland's economy because of that decision that was taken. Now, as the First Minister stated when launching the programme for government earlier this month, the Scottish Government is determined to build an economy where everyone has a fair chance to contribute and share in the benefits of economic growth. And the Ernst & Young Attractiveness Survey of May of this year shows that in 2015, Scotland attracted more foreign direct investment projects than anywhere else in the UK outside of London. And I want to touch upon some comments that Richard Leonard had mentioned earlier on. It's a shame that Richard's not here, but I have a huge amount of sympathy. Right. I've got a huge amount of sympathy for some of the comments that Richard Leonard actually made. Got a huge amount of sympathy in terms of Indigenous companies, but at the same time, I think we also have to be fair to international companies when they do come to invest in Scotland. I'll give you two examples. IBM has been in Scotland for 62 years, and National Semiconductor, also now Texas Instruments, has been in Scotland for 46 years. I admit that the numbers of folk working in these two businesses have certainly decreased, and Texas Instruments are going to be leaving, but they've still been here up to now for 46 years. So that length of time they've been here has certainly helped contribute to not just the local economy, but the Scottish economy. And certainly continued economic recovery in Scotland is, of course, threatened by the outcome of the EU referendum. Tory recklessness in Scotland means that Scotland is facing the possibility of being taken out of the EU against its will, and it could put jobs, investment and economic growth at risk. And the report, as we've heard today, from the Fraser-Allender Institute, noted that Scotland's comparative success in attracting international investment and strength in exports over recent years, but highlighted the challenges created by Brexit, which could result in a slowdown in foreign direct investment. And analysis also shows that over the next 10 years, the level of GDP in Scotland could be between 2% and 5% lower than it would otherwise have been because of the impact of Brexit. Now, the decision to leave the EU is forecast to have a detrimental impact on long-term economic prospects. Investment, household incomes, employment, and the long-run supply potential of the economy could all be lower, although any effects may take some time to emerge. Now, David Stewart, in his contribution, he quoted the figure of some £9 billion across the UK. That's a huge amount of money to be taken out of any economy. But trade could be hit particularly hard, and the EU accounts for just over 40% of all Scotland's international exports, i.e. excluding exports to the rest of the UK, and that's more than North America, Asia, South America, the Middle East, and Australasia combined. Now, I'm quite sure Conservatives and their contributions earlier were saying but the rest of the UK is a more important trading partner. But that certainly, in terms of figures, that's there to see. However, why should we put all the eggs in that one basket? We need to make sure that Scotland's economy can actually withstand a lot of... Just 2 seconds, if I may. We need to make sure that Scotland's economy can actually withstand much of the pressures that may come from international events.
Rachel Hamilton.
Would Stuart McMillan not consider £42.6 billion versus £11.2 billion, which is the difference between the domestic market and the European market, is not significant?
Yeah great.
Stuart McMillan.
I didn't downplay the significance or otherwise of the level of trade between Scotland and the rest of the UK and also elsewhere. But what I did say is that why should we focus and put all our eggs in that one basket when, if there is some major shock in that one particular economy, then that would certainly have an adverse effect upon Scotland's economy. Now, many companies in Scotland and the rest of the UK are also part of the complex international supply chains. And this means that it's not just access to export markets, but also EU imports, which are certainly important. And in recent years, Scotland has performed well in international investment, rivaling the southeast of England as a second biggest location for FDI projects after London, and it's driven in part by the skilled workforce, but also the UK as an access point to the single market. Now, foreign direct investment has strong links to productivity through the transfer of knowledge, skills, best practice, technology and innovation. However, businesses will not and cannot adjust their plans overnight, and plant and machinery are immobile in the short run. And moreover, for the time being, Scotland and the UK remain within the EU. In terms of trade, regulation and free movement, nothing has changed thus far. And it's likely to be only a matter of time, however, before expectations of reduced integration feed through to day-to-day investment production operations, R&D activities, employment and household spending decisions. And on that point about R&D, R&D is absolutely vital for the future of the economy. And I mean, the example I will give certainly will be IBM in 1999-2000, when the R&D department closed. And then the assembly and manufacturing in IBM in Greenock then started to decline. Since the result of the EU referendum, the Scottish Government has lost no time in engaging fully and robustly on all fronts, and as businesses continue to face the ongoing uncertainty created by the UK-wide vote to leave the EU, our planned £500 million Scottish Growth Fund is designed to support them, the workforce and the economy to grow. And certainly the Conservatives, once again we're talking about opportunities, and I'm conscious of time, signing officer, the Conservatives are talking about opportunities, but certainly from what I can see in terms of opportunity, in terms of the opportunities for students, and the economic impact they can have, that's going to decrease if there's going to be additional costs placed upon them. The opportunity for tourism, once again, I mean, as members will know, I chair the cross-party group on recreational boating and marine tourism, and we had the strategy launched last year to actually push and promote marine tourism in Scotland. But what's going to happen to the marinas? Are they going to have visa access points installed in them for when sailors come in from EU nations? So, presiding officer, Brexit has not yet happened. There are huge challenges that's going to face Scotland and the rest of the UK, and certainly despite what the Conservatives are saying, I mean, we are in for some bumpy times ahead, and it's going to have an adverse effect upon our economy. Thank you.
Edward Mountain, to be followed by Ben McPherson.
Presiding officer, as I'd like to talk about the rural economy, I'd like to declare an interest that I'm a partner in a farming partnership in Scotland. The vote that we had on the 23rd of June resulted in a decision that I did not seek, but it's one that I totally accept because it's a democratic choice of the United Kingdom and we are part of that United Kingdom. Now, whilst in Dornoch, just after the referendum, I visited the newly refurbished coffee room in the old jailhouse. And firstly, I'd like to encourage you all to go there and to visit and see if you can resist the temptations, the edible temptations that are on offer. I couldn't. But secondly, I'd like to share with you the resolve it gave me on how to deal with Brexit. Written on the wall was the following saying: if fate hands you a lemon, make lemonade. This sums up to me what we should be doing now, and it sums up what I believe the stimulus that Scotland needs, looking at opportunities and making the most of them. It's what our can-do farmers and rural business expect us to do. What they'll never forgive us for doing is not rising to the challenge. Sadly, some of you, as been witnessed in this debate this afternoon, do not share that view and take the attitude that if fate hands you a lemon, throw it back saying it'll always be sour. Now, on the 30th of August, the rural economy in Scotland turned to us once again and expected the Parliament to start working on what's going to happen post-2020, the date when farm subsidies have been guaranteed until. And Fergus Ewing backed that up by saying that on the 13th of September, there was a need for stability in the agricultural sector. And I'd like to quote him. I'm sure that all of us in this chamber can agree that farmers and their families need certainty in these uncertain times. Now, we should be working towards that. So I call on the Scottish Government and those in this chamber. Can I just finish on my call and then I'll give way. So I'd like to call on the Scottish Government and those in this chamber to look upon the future of Scottish farming and the 65,000 people directly involved in it. And I'll give way at that stage.
Stuart McMillan.
I thank Edward Mountain for taking the intervention. His point regarding farmers and the families looking for certainty. But surely every member of the country should actually have that certainty.
Edward Mountain.
Absolutely. Uncertainty comes from knowing that we're working on things, but I'm talking about specifically the rural economy. So I want to go back to that, if I may, And I'd like to just put on this, on the rural economy, and make it on the record, if I may, that farmers in many remote rural areas, such as the Highlands, are the backbone of that economy, providing jobs, food, and looking after the environment. They do so sometimes in the most inhospitable conditions, working long hours being the norm rather than the exception. They're facing this year higher input prices, as we know, which are not reflected in farm gate prices. Indeed, many of those farmers this year sold grain and received the same price that they did 30 years ago. That's not sustainable, but it is bearable because of subsidies. And therefore, I strongly believe that all farmers, although they'd like to farm without subsidies, realistically, it's probably not possible because of the rules and regulations, especially if we demand cheap food. So we need now, as a chamber, to start working on the future of agricultural support and how we want to ensure food security. I think we have a real opportunity, and the opportunity is not ours to squander by saying, I want to remain in the EU and won't consider the alternatives. We'll be seen as being petulant and destructive. So I want to move on and ask about protecting our markets. For example, we export to the EU some 34,000 tonnes of farmed salmon, which, to put it into context, is nearly two salmon for every person that lives in Scotland. It's an important market. Let me be clear, we need to retain access to that market. And to those that are already being negative, saying that this is not a concept that we can have, let me point out there are many producers in Europe who will be demanding the same access to our markets. So we need to be constructive and not destructive about opening up markets. I've given way once, and I know the presiding officer is particularly... Oh, well, if you're going to give me leeway, you said the other day you wouldn't.
Just a little. Today is a new day, Mr. Mountain.
Good way to Mr. Harvey.
In which case, I'm very grateful, and I would simply like to ask, as he's so concerned about businesses having access to the single market, does he not accept that to qualify as being a single market, citizens must have access to it as well, not just businesses, and that means the freedom to move?
Edward Mountain.
Well, you see, that's exactly the point that I'm saying and talking about. I'm saying the point is that we need to be constructive and look at all the opportunities to make sure that our businesses succeed. I fully accept, as I'm sure that everyone else does on this side of the chamber, that we need people to help us get in our harvest in the rural areas. And therefore, we should be open to that as well as being open to exporting food. But just by saying that we've got to give freedom of movement actually is not being constructive. It's being limiting. So I want to now just go on, if I may, having answered that question, is to look at trade deals, because trade deals are a real possibility. And I think we should be looking to working with the UK government to make these a reality. We've identified areas, and everyone here knows on them, how we can improve on trade deals. Reducing the 3,000% duty on whiskey imports to Egypt. Reducing and getting rid of the ban on beef and lamb imports to the USA. We need to be working with the government in the UK, saying that we are open for business, and not just saying to them, we're not going to play in the reforms that lie ahead, which I fear is some people's approach. Now, I hope that the appointment of Mike Russell will lead to positive discussions, and not just another chance to seek to do what his party believe in, which is state the negatives of Brexit, and suggest that the only way forward is by independence. Now, there's one other issue I'd like to dwell on, if I may, and that is environmental regulations. For too long, managers, whether farmers, keepers, conservation or foresters, have had to deal with EU legislation that regulates and restricts what they do. We now have the very real opportunity to look again at these regulations, and we should take that. What we should not do, however, is rush blindly into replacing the rules which have been EU-driven by rules that don't serve Scotland. We have got to make sure that the new rules do. Now, for example, earlier this year, the EU went through the process of trying to ban glyphosate, and this failed because we were only given an extension for 18 months. It's a vital chemical that we use, not only farmers, but councils and gardeners. There's no suitable alternative. And so to lose that would be a disaster. So we should start to welcome the opportunities that Brexit might offer us and review the regulations, but not taking the lowest common denominator.
Yeah, so, your extension is rapidly running out, Mr. Mountain.
OK, I promise not to wear that T-shirt again, Presiding Officer, but... So throughout what I've said, I hope it's possible you'll see that there's a common theme from what I'm saying. We've not chosen to be where we are with the EU, but to fight it is not constructive. What is constructive is to seize the opportunities that have been created, run with them as farmers and rural businesses do every day and will expect us to do. So I simply say to the Chamber, with our lemons, we must make lemonade and not just continue to make sour-looking faces.
My face was in great danger of becoming very, sir. Can I call Ben McPherson, please, the last of the open speeches?
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Before being elected, I spent several years working as a commercial lawyer at the heart of Scotland's economic activity. And in my experience in that role and in other roles, I have witnessed firsthand just how much of an attractive and stable place Scotland is to do business. And let us remember that. While, of course, there is the need for improvement, and we do face significant challenges, our professional services sector is world-class, the depth and quality of our labour market is outstanding, we have phenomenal natural resources, wide-ranging creativity, highly successful established industries, and strong growth in new pioneering sectors. And, Presiding Officer, in recent years, Scotland's productivity rate has grown at a faster pace than the rest of the UK. As has already been mentioned, inward investment has expanded. And also, as has been mentioned, employment levels are up. And so, Presiding Officer, in the context of the Brexit vote, let us emphasise that Scotland is still very much an attractive and stable place to do business. However, with the Brexit vote, there is no doubt that the outcome of that EU referendum does present very significant challenges. And so that is why I warmly welcome the measures announced by the Cabinet Secretary today, particularly the 0.5 billion investment from the Scottish Government to establish a new Scottish growth scheme, and also the move that the First Minister took in the summer to bring forward 100 million of additional capital spending to boost the economy in these uncertain times. These measures will support startups and export growth. They will have a multiplier effect and create demand in our local economies, and they will have a direct impact on job creation, and we should all welcome that. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government is taking action to support our economy and mitigate the immediate effects of Brexit. And what's baffling to me and many others in our communities and in the business community is why the UK government isn't doing similar. In order to support the economy in my constituency and across Scotland, and indeed across this island, I strongly urge the UK government to follow the initiative of the Scottish government and lead at the earliest opportunity and bring forward a set of meaningful measures to stimulate the economy. What's more, Presiding Officer, we also need answers from the UK government. As has been highlighted by several speakers today, another week is passing without clarity or comment from the British government about membership of the single market. We have had no comment in recent times on the legal status of EU citizens. And furthermore, Presiding Officer, financial services, which are a very important part of our economy, as highlighted by Stuart Stevenson, and particularly important here in Edinburgh. Because of that importance, we need clarity from the British government about retaining passporting rights for that finance sector post-Brexit, so that Scottish banks and other financial service companies can continue to operate anywhere in the EU while still based in Scotland. Last week at PMQs, my colleague Deirdre Brock MP asked the Prime Minister whether she could give any assurances on this matter. And almost a week later, there still haven't been any assurances from the Prime Minister or from the British Government at all. Presiding Officer, what was interesting last week at Prime Minister's questions when Deirdre Brock asked the Prime Minister on the issue of financial passporting, the Prime Minister dodged answering this legitimate and important question about a hugely important sector with empty words about an independence referendum. And again today, it's the Scottish Conservatives who are going on about another independence referendum. The fact of the matter is, the reason why the Tories are talking about independence is because they don't have answers about Brexit. As I've already said, the Scottish Government has been taking action, noticeable action, meaningful action, since the Brexit vote on the 24th of June. And the British Government have done astoundingly little, almost next to nothing. Week after week in the last months, I've heard Conservative MSPs in this chamber or in media interviews that they've done at different points assert that the business community are significantly worried about the possibility of another Scottish independence referendum. However, the fact of the matter is, on the ground and in the boardrooms across Scotland, and in my experience of talking to all sorts of different businesses, from SMEs to PLCs, the most significant worry and concern for businesses in Scotland, the big issue, is the real uncertainty about Brexit and the lack of clarity from the British government. Now, the Tories might want to keep trying to avoid talking about Brexit by using independence as a smokescreen, but there's no getting away from the real issues that face us about Brexit. Issues that have arisen as a result of a vote that's contrary to the popular will of the Scottish people, a Brexit result presided over and actively pursued by members of the British government. A Brexit vote that we've, as Stuart McMillan rightly highlighted, yet to see the full consequences of. Presiding officer, in the face of the challenges of Brexit, which we are facing together, I urge the British government to follow the Scottish Government's example, to follow its lead, by investing in a meaningful stimulus package to create demand and growth, and by giving clarity on passporting rights for the finance sector and the single market. The people of Scotland are waiting and listening, and they need answers soon.
We now move to the closing speeches. Now, I have to say I was a bit overgenerous to some backbenchers, so if we could be fairly tight, please, in the closing speeches. And we have a very indignant looking Jackie Bailey. 7 minutes, please, Ms. Bailey.
Not at all. I think I was sucking on one of Edward Mountain's lemons. Could I welcome Michael Russell to his new post? But he will forgive me if I don't join in Tom Arthur's very gushing tribute to him. It's perhaps the most gushing tribute I've ever heard in this chamber. Mr. Arthur clearly wants a promotion. And I do hope the Minister will absolutely resist Edward Mountain's suggestion that somehow we treat our response to Brexit as some kind of great British bake-off, with the key ingredient being lemons. I've heard it all today, Presiding Officer. But let me welcome the opportunity to debate the impact of Brexit on the Scottish economy. It is the case that the people of Scotland voted by a significant margin to remain in the European Union. It is important that we respect that, that we reflect on people's wishes as we move forward. The Minister would, of course, expect me to point out that it is also the case that an equally significant margin voted to remain in the United Kingdom. And we equally need to respect and reflect their wishes too. So the challenge for us is how we give expression to both. And I would encourage the government to do so too, because I genuinely believe that the SNP will not be forgiven if they use very positive sentiments towards the European Union simply as a means of achieving independence. Instead, I hope they focus on getting the very best deal for Scotland, and in that, we support them wholeheartedly. There is no doubt, Presiding Officer, that Brexit will have an impact on our economy. The overwhelming majority of commentators and economists believe that the impact will be negative. The Cabinet Secretary referred to an array of statistics which demonstrate that decline in economic growth. Already, though, we have seen signs of decline, but these were evident before Brexit. Scotland is underperforming the rest of the UK across a range of economic measures, and I don't think any of us believe that that's good enough. On employment, on productivity, on growth, we are behind the rest of the UK. And growth projections have all been revised downwards, not just this year, but in previous years, as Fraser of Allender last year described. Well, hold on a second. Let me just put this point to you, because last year, Fraser of Allender described the economy as flirting with recession. I believe we may have gone beyond flirtation, and the consequences of that for the Scottish economy would be serious indeed, for jobs and for workers in our communities. And I'd be pleased to hear what the Scottish Government will do about that.
Keith Brown.
I'm not sure, can I thank Jackie Bailey for taking the intervention? I'll not go into beyond flirtation, but can I just say that in relation to employment, the simple fact is the Scottish economy is outperforming the UK economy. And not only that, it's outperforming every year of the Labour Liberal Democrat administration as well.
Jackie,
can I say that, you know, it is welcome that on that particular statistic, we're now moving in the right direction. But one quarter of improvement does not, in my view, is enough to actually deal with the underperformance of the Scottish economy. So I do hope that the Cabinet Secretary will be more ambitious. Let me echo some of the points made by Richard Leonard, because I think they're important. They demonstrate how precarious our economy is. It is the case that between 2007 and 15, the size of the Scottish economy, which is overseas owned, grew from 23% to 34%. And that's quite a staggering increase in an incredibly short space of time. On the face of it, that seems like positive news. The Scottish Government, though, themselves concluded that Scotland outside the EU makes the country a less attractive location for overseas investors. We know that there are 1,000 EU-owned companies in Scotland employing something like 115,000 people. There are others out with the EU that invest here to gain a foothold in that single market. So Richard Leonard is right. We are more vulnerable to economic shocks as a consequence of our over-reliance on overseas-owned companies. Stuart McMillan shouldn't misunderstand this. Of course, inward investment is welcome. But we are vulnerable, more vulnerable, because of Brexit, and it needs to be balanced against growth in our indigenous industry. The statistics tell us that we are much more exposed to the negative impact of Brexit than any other part of the UK. I want to turn to the Scottish Government's response, but before I do, let me make an observation. Because the SNP point to the UK government and say that they must do something. The Tories point to the Scottish government and say, no, it's the Scottish government's responsibility. Frankly, that's the politics of the playground. The people of Scotland expect both governments to work together to protect our interests and enhance our economy. Now, I agree with the Scottish government's view that there should be measures outlined in the autumn statement, and we really need more than a slogan and an empty Brexit means Brexit to take the country forward. But that said, I think the Scottish Government can and must do more itself. The 100 million capital stimulus is welcome, but wholly inadequate. You know, a point Jenny Mara made very well. This is underspend from last year. I was told in a PQ answered today that that money is expected to support 800 jobs, half of them in construction. Well, that's great. But I have to say to you, when you set this against the scale of the challenge we face, 8,000 construction jobs lost just in the last year. Analysis by Fraser of Allender Institute suggesting that unemployment will rise by more than 10,000 in the next 2 years. When faced with those challenges, do you really, really think that that is ambitious enough? Now, I have to say, you know, the 500 million business growth scheme, again, welcome. But has it yet been agreed with the Treasury? Because it is a loan guarantee scheme. There's not actually 500 million on the table. Now, I have to say to you as gently as I can, you will not be forgiven for announcing something where the detail has not been worked out, marching businesses up to the top of the hill and then abandoning them when you get there. I expect more from the Scottish Government. The Cabinet Secretary invited suggestions, and I'll do so very quickly. But could I maybe make the suggestion that they look particularly at different economic sectors? Because economists say that the impact is likely to be variable, dependent on the sector. So understanding that will be important in informing our response. Scottish Labour set out a range of measures in our Brexit Action Plan, which was published at the start of the summer, and I would commend that to the Cabinet Secretary. But in closing, Presiding Officer, finally, let me quote the Fraser of Allender Institute, quoted by many in the Chamber already. They said, the economic strategy's priorities have been turned on their head by Brexit. It's simply not possible for policy to continue as normal. It's absolutely not business as usual. So, Presiding Officer, I would encourage the Scottish Government and the UK Government to get serious about this, to get beyond business as usual, address the challenges facing our economy, our businesses and our people.
Mr Lockhart, we're very tight now. Under 9 minutes, please.
Understood. Thank you, Presiding Officer. Let me start by welcoming Mr Russell to his new role. And I also welcome the opportunity to be involved in a debate with Mr Brown, despite the fact that he never really answers questions we ask him. Presiding Officer, as you would expect, we've had a lively and interesting debate in the Chamber this afternoon. During the debate, a number of members, especially on this side of the Chamber, highlighted the opportunities arising from Brexit, and others have discussed the policy response required to help to stimulate the economy. Before reflecting on those contributions, I would like to consider, what does Brexit mean economically for Scotland? First of all, let me start by making it very clear that Brexit is not to blame for the current underperformance of the Scottish economy, as suggested by Mr Brown. If you look at the longer-term figures, it is clear the underperformance in the Scottish economy has been a central feature of this government's track record. Let me give Mr Brown just one example. The current size of the Scottish economy is only 4% above pre-recession levels of 2008, whereas the rest of the UK has grown 23% in that same period. How has that been stronger for Scotland? And just to remind Mr Brown, this includes periods when the oil price was above $110 a barrel. Mr Brown has also failed to deliver on the SNP's productivity target to have Scotland's productivity levels in the first quartile by next year. Sure.
Keith Brown.
Given his view of the Scottish economy, does he accept, as David Mundell appears to do, there are two governments active in the economy, or is it simply the case everything he wants to deride about the Scottish economy is the responsibility of the Scottish government? Is it two governments or one?
Dean Lockhart.
The divergence of the Scottish economy has been shown to be caused largely by uncertainty caused by the independence referendum. It has been shown. And, well, let me say this. Business rates in Scotland with the large business supplement are twice the rates of England, against what Mr Swinney said in the last Parliament. Perhaps that's another reason why the Scottish economy is underperforming. Let's be clear on this point. Brexit is not to blame for the economic stagnation we're facing in Scotland. It is the SNP's mismanagement of the economy, the failure of policy implementation, and the constant agitation for the second referendum on independence. Presiding Officer, in considering what Brexit really means for the Scottish economy, we need to look at our export markets and how we generate wealth. Our exports fall into three main categories. Exports going to the rest of the UK, which account for 64% of our exports, making the UK by far our largest customer. Exports going to the European single market, accounting for 15%, and exports going to the rest of the world, accounting for 21%. Presiding Officer, there's one thing that is crystal clear in all of the post-Brexit analysis. Our economic and financial relationship with the UK is more important than ever. Our membership of the UK single market is worth four times, as a number of my colleagues have said, is worth four times as much in terms of exports and jobs as the EU. And financially, as was highlighted by the GERS numbers, we benefit significantly by being a member of the United Kingdom to the tune of £15 billion. Go ahead.
Alistair Allen.
Thank the member for giving way. I'm glad he acknowledges the importance of the European single market. Does he draw a distinction between the two issues, which I think one of his colleagues failed to draw a distinction between, which is membership of and access to the single market?
Dean Lockhart.
Yes, look, I think we've made our position quite clear. The real issue... Yeah, we have. The real issue, if you allow me to answer, the real issue is the level of access to the single market and the terms upon which that access is negotiated. And that can be a bespoke agreement. The United Kingdom is the second largest economy in Europe, one of the fastest, if not the fastest growing economies in Europe. Europe exports more to us than vice versa, so I'm pretty sure we will have a strong negotiating position. Exactly. Presiding Officer, the SNP's plans for Scotland to leave the UK and then try to rejoin the European Union, although a number of member states have said they would veto that, make no economic sense whatsoever. However, we now know that the economy is a second consideration for the SNP. The First Minister of the weekend has told us the case for independence ultimately transcends the issues of Brexit, of oil and national wealth. Well, Mr Brown, try telling that to the 120,000 people who have lost their jobs in the North Sea in the two-year period after the SNP white paper said the oil price would remain above $110 a barrel. Small consolation. President Officer, let me now turn to the opportunities arising from Brexit, because they are extensive and global, and they have been outlined by my colleagues on this side of the chamber across a number of different sectors: farming, fishing, energy, tourism, and a number of manufacturing, as well as other exporters. The depreciation of sterling has resulted in a boost to our exporters, including the food and drink industry, the largest exporter in Scotland. Sure, go ahead.
I'm terribly sorry, I just had one of these blanks.
Oh, no, that's
Kate
fine.
Forbes.
Great. Would Mr Lockhart and the rest of the Chamber join me in welcoming the news this afternoon that the Home Office has granted my constituents, the Brain family, the right to remain in Scotland? And would Mr Lockhart agree that it's about time that his party gave the rest of the EU citizens who are resident in Scotland the same assurance that they can remain?
Dean Lockhart.
We've said that's going to be one of the priorities in our discussions with our European counterparts, and I welcome the news of your constituents. Thank you for that. Presiding Officer, there are challenges arising from Brexit, but when we talk to businesses, business tell us there are challenges in business every day, and you know what? They're getting on with it. It's now time for Mr Brown and his colleagues to follow the leadership shown by the Scottish business community and get on with the day job and take advantage of the opportunities that we have outlined in this chamber. In terms of policy response, Presiding Officer, what steps can the Scottish Government take to stimulate the economy? Well, first of all, it is clear they can do much other than blame Westminster or Brexit. The Fraser or Valander Institute described the new powers coming to Holyrood as fiscal devolution of a scale that is largely unprecedented internationally. Do something about it. You've got the powers. What can the Scottish Government do in the short term to use these powers? Well, first of all, Mr Brown, you could listen to business for a change. For example, the letter sent to the government from 13 leading business organisations earlier this month, before your programme for government was published, asking, demanding in fact, for the large business supplement to be abolished. A tax that punishes businesses that want to expand, and a tax that has forced the closure of many long-standing, otherwise successful businesses, such as Macquarie's in your neighbouring constituency. In addition, Presiding Officer, my colleagues have listed a whole range of global opportunities and steps that can be taken. If the SNP don't want to listen to us, then perhaps it can listen to the views of the various business leaders who have been setting out the opportunities. Most fundamentally, the SNP should listen to their own pro-independence business leaders and take off the table the prospect of another independence referendum. Yeah, yeah. Instead of listening to business, however, the SNP last week set out in the programme for government a list of economic measures that amounted to nothing more than repackaged policy announcements and old money dressed up as new. The headline announcement of the new Scottish growth scheme has been, frankly, an omni-shambles. It has caused confusion in the business community. Businesses are asking, how will this help be? Is it in the form of loans? Is it guarantees? How does the guarantee scheme work? Who will administer the scheme? What will be the criteria? Have the banks or the investment community even been consulted, let alone the UK Treasury? It's interesting that in its programme for government, the SNP admits that in order for this scheme to work appropriately, we will discuss in detail with business organisations, the Scottish Parliament and the UK Government. Perhaps going forward, Mr Brown, you can consider having proper consultation going forward on an important economic policy and listen to the views of business in advance of announcing policies that no one knows how they're going to work. Let me conclude by saying the First Minister recently also said that we're facing a lost decade as a result of Brexit negotiations.
You well, must conclude, Officer, Mr Lockhart.
The people of Scotland know only too well what it feels like to suffer a lost decade, and that is a lost decade under this Scottish
now,
government.
Now, please, Mr Lockhart.
I support,
I'm sorry, Mr
support
Lockhart, you have to
Murdo
sit down.
Name.
You're close. I now call Mike Russell up until 5 o'clock, please, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank the Chamber for what has been an interesting debate? Let me start with what the debate is about and what it isn't about. The Conservative Party is nothing if not on message. Yesterday, Theresa May, in a briefing from Downing Street, let the Telegraph understand
The problem with the Scottish Government is that they were allowing the ideology of independence to be more important than the economy. And that is the message we've heard from the Tories today. The reality of this debate is something different. The reality is that the Tory party allowed the ideology of Brexit to be more important than the economy. And that is what we are now seeing. That is what Scotland potentially could suffer from. And our job is to make sure that doesn't happen. During the course of this debate, I have to say there were two people I agreed with most, neither of whom are on my own benches, and I'm sorry that I have to say that, although of course I agreed with all our benches, and particularly the wisdom of Tom Arthur, who I thought made a particularly fine start to his speech. But I do want to say that I thought Patrick Harvey and Tavish Scott made very important points. Patrick Harvey is absolutely right to say that the Scottish Government will need to have clear positions based on clear principles. The Scottish Government will have to articulate them and be prepared to negotiate hard for them. Now, two of those are already clear. The single market, based on the four freedoms, based on free movement, because we are all descended from migrants of one sort or another, based on free movement is vitally important. And there's a very limited understanding in this chamber of what that means, because free movement is not negotiable. And the talk that in some way it could be negotiated away is nonsense, and we saw that from the Bratislava summit this weekend. Our policies will also require to be fact-based, and they'll have to make sure that they give us good foundations for future success. And the disappointment this afternoon was in the Tory refusal to be where they were immediately after the referendum, to take the positive view of ensuring there was a Scottish approach that benefited Scotland, because the Tories have become born-again Brexiteers. Now, the other contribution I thought was important was Tavish Scott, and not because he defined the purpose of these debates just to give me something to do in my afternoons, which is not true, but because he defined the purpose of the debate to encourage a positive approach and to give ideas. And then, unusually in this debate, he went on and gave some ideas. I don't agree with all the ideas that he gave, but I thought it was very positive to do that. And it was a change from some of the other rhetoric of the debate, particularly from Murdo-Fraser's reasons to be cheerful. Murdo listed those reasons to be cheerful, but they sounded more to me like whistling in the wind. Murdo-Fraser is never short of chutzpah. He wants the UK government to be in the lead on absolutely everything, except when it is rudderless and drifting. Then it is the SNP's absolute responsibility to be in the lead on everything. That is an admirable approach. It's just very, very silly, I have to say. Because, of course.
Murdo-Fraser.
I'm most grateful to the Minister for giving way. I wonder if he could answer the question that none of his colleagues could answer. Why does he think it is the case that business confidence has recovered post-Brexit in every part of the United Kingdom, apart from in Scotland? What is it about Scotland uniquely that means that business confidence here has not recovered?
I think it's very important that we study that. But let me give you a suggestion. The suggestion might be that Scottish business is wiser than business elsewhere. It realises we haven't had Brexit yet, and the worst is yet to come. It could be that. But let me turn to the Tory party, because we are sort of used now to the Tory party of being constitutional anoraks. That's what they do. But they are born-again Brexiteers. They're absolutely. Liam Kerr said in an interview in The Lawyer just after the referendum, we need to take stock of the referendum result. Well, they certainly took stock. They're now 100% in favour of it. Success, according to the Russian proverb, has many parents. Failure is an orphan. It's difficult to find anybody on the benches who doesn't now believe, the Tory benches, that Brexit is not only the right thing to happen, but the Scottish Government should embrace it with such enthusiasm as if we were in favour of it all the time. Just one moment. Jumping on the bandwagon, however, is a dangerous thing to do. The Brexit. I hope the Lib Dems aren't jumping on the bandwagon too. That would be a big disappointment, having been so nice to Mr. Scott. Jumping on the bandwagon is a dangerous thing to do. This bandwagon is careering downhill. It's not possible to steer it. It's knocking down all sorts of valuable things. And the question isn't how are the SNP going to get it under control. There are much better questions to ask. How can we, for example, together create an approach based on what is best for Scotland? How can we find the right option for Scotland? How can we ensure that in these situations we benefit business and we benefit Scotland and don't disadvantage it? Those are good questions. but we haven't had the answer to them from the Tories today. Well, we had a sort of answer. We had an answer from Edward Mountain, who told us in a sort of mystical way that we should all be given a lemon. Let me give him the classic economic theory of giving everyone a lemon. If you give everyone a lemon, there's a collapse in the price of lemonade and penury for lemonade manufacturers. That's the reality if everybody has a lemon. Now, what we need to do is to find a way that we can come together as a chamber and debate the ideas. And that's why Mr. Scott's contribution and Patrick Harvey's contribution were so important. There needs to be a contribution of ideas in this debate. And let's start with the idea of what the single market actually is. This Parliament voted for a motion last week stating that a key objective must be for Scotland and the UK to remain inside the single market. There is a fundamental difference between membership of the single market and simply having access to it, in line with the terms of what would be called a free trade agreement. The latter outcome would risk what the First Minister has termed a lost decade, undoubtedly, and even more. And then, strangely enough, the single market as it presently exists, and of course it needs reform, is a creation of the UK. Under the leadership of Jacques Delors, it was the UK commissioner who led work on the ambitious programme of 272 measures to break down the non-tariff barriers to the deliver of an integrated European market. And by aiming for that free movement of goods and services, the single market is much more effective than a simple free trade area. That's particularly true in the case of services. The Scotch whisky industry benefits, yes, but the Scottish financial sector even more, because a fundamental element of the single market is passporting, the right of a financial service firm incorporated in one member state to establish a branch or provide services remotely on a service basis in another member state, solely on the basis of their authorisation and supervision by the state of incorporation. That's a fundamental provision. And you can't have that without accepting the principle of free movement. I noted papers reporting at the weekend that the Chancellor thought that could be negotiated for the banking sector and for nobody else. So Brexit means free movement for bankers, but not for workers. That doesn't appear to be a sensible way to go ahead. Now I return, Presiding Officer, to where we started in this debate. There are a key set of issues that need to be discussed in the economy, and future debates are going to discuss issues in other sectors, issues in the rural economy, issues of environment, issues of education, issues of justice. And if we're going to do justice to that debate, then members need to come to the chamber with the ideas that they can put forward. We all know what we think about each other politically. What we don't know is the way in which every sector in Scotland will be affected. We don't know the positive natures that we might take and the negatives as well. And until we have that discussion and that debate, then we won't be much further forward. So, Presiding Officer, we have decided, I have to say, despite no Labour speech being in any way complimentary about the Scottish Government, with the exception of David Stewart, I make an exception for him as ever, despite that, we've decided to accept the Labour amendment and would have accepted the Liberal Democratic amendment had it been called. Both those amendments are in the spirit of saying we have to get the information together, we have to be positive, but we can't disguise the difficulties ahead. Unfortunately, the Conservatives today want to disguise the difficulties ahead. Nobody, not, and especially not the business sector, will thank them for that.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the debate on Scotland's economy. We now move to decision time. There are three questions to be put as a result of today's business, and I wish to remind members that if the amendment in the name of Murdo-Fraser is successful, the amendment in the name of Richard-Leonard falls. The first question is that the amendment in the name of Murdo-Fraser, which seeks to amend motion number 1531 in the name of Keith Brown on Scotland's economy, be agreed. Are we all agreed? No. We are not agreed. Parliament will move to a vote, and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on Amendment 1531.1 in the name of Murdo-Fraser is as follows. Yes, 29. No, 88. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. The next question is that Amendment 1531.3 in the name of Richard-Leonard, which seeks to amend motion in the name of Keith Brown, be agreed. Or are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. Parliament will move to a vote and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on Amendment 1531.3 is as follows. Yes, 87. No, 29. There were no abstentions. The amendment to the name of Richard Leonard is therefore agreed. The next question is that Motion 1531 in the name of Keith Brown, as amended, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. Parliament will move to a vote and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on motion 1531, the name of Keith Brown, is as amended, is as follows. Yes, 87. No, 29. There were no abstentions. The motion as amended is therefore agreed. That concludes business. We move now, decision time, we move now to members' business. I'll take a few minutes to change seats. Minister to change seats.